and gentlemen, and welcome inside the Burridge Gymnasium here at McMaster University in Hamilton, Ontario. We are at max capacity, standing room only, in what promises to be a fantastic final in what is the 50th anniversary of the CIS Men's Volleyball Championship. I'm Jared Brown, and I'm joined once again by Everett DeLorme and Dan Gilbert. We have the two top teams in the country, the number one ranked hometown team, McMaster Marauders, taking on the Canada West champs, number two seed, Trinity Western University Spartans. This promises to be a fantastic battle. And Dan, when it comes to McMaster, who are we looking out for?
We need to focus on number seven, Stephen Marr. Stephen has been incredible for the McMaster Marauders throughout this tournament. 6'7", fourth year player. He's had 33 kills so far this tournament, which is fifth in the tournament, averaging 5.5 kills per set. That's first in the tournament. A 580 kill percentage, first in the tournament, 13 digs. He's also got 6.9 points per set, which is also first in the tournament. So without a doubt, we got to watch for Stephen Marr. He is one of the emotional leaders on this team, often igniting his team with some big energy after some huge plays.
We're just going to quickly step aside for the national anthem. We'll be back with you after this. Promises to be fantastic. That anthem doesn't get you going, you're not alive. Everett, when it comes to Trinity Western, who's their big gun?
Let me gather myself here. I still got chills after that national anthem. Well, we knew, saw it last night. We've seen it all year long. Blake Shearhorn is the guy to stop. Last night, gigantic performance, 30 points, 46 kills for the tournament, first in the tournament. He's got an average of 5.11 kills per set, which is good enough for second one. 90 total attacks, so he's almost hitting at 50%, which is crazy. Adding 10 digs and a 4.44 hitting percentage, that's red hot.
We're going to quickly toss it over to Amanda Weldon, who is courtside.
Yeah, it's going to be all about energy tonight, guys. You know, you can hear the crowd behind me right now. McMaster, the hometown heroes, they handed out 1,000 of these Boozuelas, and the energy is absolutely pouring in. You want to talk about energy as well? We're talking about last night's game. McMaster had big energy in that game. You know, overall, the whole team, you see Andrew Richards there just bringing the energy. You know, you see Danny Jaminenko, Stephen Marr, they're celebrating, they're coming together as a team, and it's a really big opportunity for them. This is the fifth time they're having a chance coming to CIS Finals, and it means so much for these hometown heroes. So we're going to throw it back to you guys on the desk, and let's get this thing started.
Thank you, Amanda. We'll be hearing from you all night long on courtside. The teams are ready to go. And guys, in terms of a matchup, the atmosphere, you know, everything about this, I'm not sure if we could ask for a better situation than Trinity Western McMaster here, the hometown team. You know, the storylines, Trinity Western, can they get back to the podium after being off for 2 years? McMaster, and they finally break through and win that gold medal in the 50th anniversary of this championship in their gym. I don't know, because I have no idea what's going to happen. It promises to be fantastic action, but that's all I can guarantee.
Absolutely, and no team from the OUA has won since the 70s, since the University of Ottawa's done it. They did it back then, and they don't even have a team anymore in Trinity Western Spartans, the other side. Last year they were in this very same match, lost to Alberta, but to get there, they beat this McMaster team. Also, looking at the Trinity Western side, their big horse, their big gun, Blake Shearhor from Ontario, and he's playing his first tournament, first matches in Ontario since his club days. So huge motivation on his side of the net to kind of, you know, take that away from his friends and guys he's played against throughout his entire career. But on the other side, the McMaster Marauders and their seventh man that we can already hear as we're about to get this first serve going that away.
The serve from Shearhorn, and it sails long, and that gets the crowd on their feet right off the hop. First point of the night goes to the Marauders. And now going back to serve for Mac will be Danny Demianko.
Not what the Spartans wanted. They wanted to maybe take the crowd out of it early, and we're already getting a taste of how loud this gym's going to be.
Shearhorn was near perfect last night, only three hitting errors in that five-set match. Demianko gives the serve right back. And the Trinity Western fans, they are definitely outnumbered, I'll tell you that, but there is still a portion of them here in the stands.
And these service errors that we're seeing has been typical all championship early on in each match. They'll settle down and start putting them in the court.
Literally can't hear, and we're right beside each other here in the booth as Elliot gets the kill in the middle, and the Vuvuzelas are out in full effect.
Yeah, flashbacks to the 2010 World Cup in South Africa. They are just everywhere. It's loud every time Mac scores a point.
Yeah, the entire town, the entire community has rallied around this team. And I think almost the entire city of Hamilton is trying to get into this. They're standing room only as Young Gieski with a huge dig. Copper, high ball to Mar. And Mar blocked there by Betcher and Schreimer. And that's something that's been an interesting matchup. The block of Trinity Western versus the attack of McMaster.
One of the keys to the game for Trinity Western is their defense, but their defense all starts with their block alignment, and we saw it right there. They are a big blocking team, and if they can get that in front of McMaster, it's going to make it tough.
Schreimer back to serve, taken there by Coppers, pass off the net. Coker, high ball to McCarthy, and the big lefty. That's kept alive by Elliott off the soft block. Back to Mar with the tip. Betcher gets a piece, but Trinity Western is on the net. But already we're seeing Trinity Western touching many balls in the net here, making life difficult for this McMaster attack.
It'll be interesting to see how long it takes Mac to adjust to the size of blocking of the Spartans. They don't see this all year long in the OUA. There's no team that matches up with them physically. Last night they got a taste of it against the Huskies, but Trinity Western, a much larger and much more physical team than those Huskies.
Ball handling violation there from Schreimer. The pass was pulled way over to the left and off the net. Tried to make an athletic set. Just got a little bit sticky in his hands there. Point to Mac, 4-2, they lead.
We haven't seen very many ball handling calls this tournament. That one was pretty bad.
Yeah, just a little bit of a miss hit on that one there from Schreimer. Mar, big serve, taken by Kozlowski, passes tight, Coppers puts it down. And interesting, last night, Saskatchewan came out of the gates flying, kind of took the crowd out of it a little bit. It's only early, we're at 5-2, but the crowd continues to rear and roar here. I don't know if you could put any more people in this gym if you tried. We are packed. That serve from Mar, long. And now it is Slater back to serve, the fourth year outside. Slater from Port Coquitlam, BC. Pass there by Umjewski, Coker, middle, Elliott, and Alex Elliott, the only fifth year on this McMaster team, comes out of the gates flying.
You know, and that's not Elliott's style to get a big bang like that, especially with the blockers in front of him. But you can tell he's amped up for his last CIS match ever.
Now he goes back to serve, the Cobourg, Ontario product. Mentioned only fifth year on this team. Kozlowski, the only fifth year for Trinity Western. Shearhorn dug up by Mar. Coker, backset to Demianko, tipped over. Betcher gets a piece. Schreimer on the run, outside to Shearhorn. Mar, another dig in transition. Coker back to McCarthy, and McCarthy finds the corner. 7-3 Marauders.
And a great kill from McCarthy. He's been a guy that's been a little bit silent throughout this tournament, and it's nice to see him get involved early in the offense. One of the things that we see with the serving between these two teams is a balance of float and spin servers. McMaster's going to send many more spin servers back than Trinity Western.
Oh, and a service ace for Elliott. Kozlowski thought he got there, but not quite enough.
And in line with what I was going to say, the float serves have seemed to be giving a lot of difficulty to teams throughout this tournament. So Trinity Western bringing 5 out of 6 of their players with the float serve. McMaster will bring a lot of power with their spins, as we see Elliott floating for them now.
Takes Betcher quickly outside to Shearhorn. Shearhorn dug up there by Mar. Coker high ball to Coppers, and Coppers off the top of the block. A big lead opening up here for McMaster, 9-3, and Coach Josephson will call a first early timeout, and that gets Coach Preston smiling. He loves to start for his McMaster team here.
Absolutely, and you can feel the energy in this place, and they're riding the wave of that crowd right after that national anthem got started. The McMaster Riders were going for it, and so far, Trinity Western just can't handle the heat, and McMaster on defense. They're there, they're ready to battle for every ball, and they've just been picking up a few more than Trinity Western has.
With this McMaster team, one of the things that they want to be careful about right now is that they don't get overly activated in this environment. They want to maintain their composure. So they want to use that seventh man to their advantage, but at the same time, you got to make sure that you don't get overactivated, start taking too many risks, and give the advantage back to Trinity Western. You want to just keep on playing your game.
Well, and if you're Trinity Western, right, you lost that first set yesterday to Alberta, okay, before you battled back in the second and third, then they lost the fourth, won the fifth. So, I mean, not that you want to be down, and this can't be a comfortable situation, but, you know, it's 6 points. It's still very, very early, though, in this match. Just thinking about getting a side out here and chip away as Betcher's attack finds the sideline, and now they'll go back to the service line and just work their way through this as we see Gutzen will check into the front row now for the Spartans. The crowd didn't like it, but that did find the sideline. And now Betcher goes back to serve, and he has been a dangerous server. He has given teams a lot of fits with this deep float serve. That one finds the end line almost on cue. Service ace, Aaron Betcher.
You know, it's interesting because McMaster's serve receive on float serves like that is so close to the attack line. And that ball was a good foot and a half in, and still McMaster made no play on it.
Yeah, we mentioned that in yesterday's game against Saskatchewan, as they have a very high service line as Betcher's serve goes in the net. So they have such big left sides, they can afford to do that. It's tough to serve the ball over them. I think they just thought that previous one was out.
Yeah, Betcher made a perfect serve just over the top, and he goes at Young Jayevsky, who's much shorter than either Marr or Coppers.
10-5, Mack McCarthy on the line. Lefty spin serve taken there by Ploctis. Trimer falls. Goosen bumps it outside to Shearhorn, and Shearhorn into the net. The Trinity players are saying that McMaster was on the net.
Real unfortunate break there for Trimer as he lost his footing on this floor. It can sometimes happen as you get towards the end of the championship with the sport court getting a little bit dirty and slippery in places.
Yeah, we saw it quite a bit in the last match in the bronze medal game. You're having to wonder how this sport court is holding up.
Kozlowski with the pass. They go pipe to Slater, and they're going to call a back row violation. They're saying his foot was on the attack line. 12-5 now, Mack. This has got to be the dream start if you're Coach Dave Preston. Now they haven't ever really played Trinity Western, and speaking with their coaching staff before the match, and they've done some exhibitions with Alberta, you know, but this year they haven't done much to them. But of course, the big one was last year in that semifinal where Trinity Western beat McMaster 3 straight. And that's what's such an interesting part about this Nationals, as we see the kill there from Shearhorn, is you can play a team in the national final that you haven't seen all year. Mm-hmm.
And it's especially interesting to see this Trinity Western Spartan here. You know, after that national final, they lose a guy like Nick Del Bianco. And sure, you've got Shearhorn and Slater, but there's really no one who can place a player of the year like that. And, you know, at that time, you probably wouldn't have expected them to be in a national final. But here they are, not only Canada West champs, but in this spot here.
Nice kill there from Demianko in the middle. Now Coppers goes back to serve. 13-6.
McMaster now attacking at 56% on their offense. We've got 6 kills and only 1 error.
Coppers jump float, taken there by Bergen, who subbed into the game in the back row. Set to Shearhorn off the net, but he's able to tip it over. And, you know, he's just so high above the net that a lot of players wouldn't be able to do much with that ball. But he's so high, it comes on a different angle, even though it was just a tip, and it caught the McMaster defense off guard.
Interesting play there, though, because Jason McCarthy read that ball perfectly. It was actually the poor block of Andrew Coker, and afterwards, McCarthy just lets him know, I'm there, let me take that ball.
Great line shot there from Stephen Marr. And the big man is not just going to go and bang away. He's got shots, too.
Great shots. They did not leave him much line to hit there. They only left him about a ball and a half, and he squeezed it through.
Demianko now back to serve. Missed his first in the net. Let's see what he does on this one here. Goes after it again. Kozlowski, nice pass. Trimer tries the dump. A great pancake save there from Shearhorn. Goodson on the right. Dug up there by Diving Coppers. Marr, left side. And that's off the block and wide. Big point there for the Marauders. 15-7.
everything going right now for the Marauders. They're playing defense. They're getting lucky bounces. Like, well, I wouldn't say that was lucky. That was quite the skilled shot, but as they're called over there for a bit of a delay and maybe a little too much emotion in that celebration, but McMaster having that perfect start.
We've asked the last 2 days, guys, can McMaster sustain this type of energy and, you know, the real outward shows of emotion? And to this point, it hasn't been an issue, and they've picked up right where they left off the last 2 days. Coker, middle, Elliott, and that's a kill. Andrew Coker is feeling it. He says, feed me more, as they go into the timeout, 16-7.
You know what? So much has been made about Brett Walsh this weekend and the skill that he has, absolutely, and it's fully deserved. Brett Walsh could possibly be the best setter in the country, but when we look back to the club days, when we look back at that Crush Volleyball Club, there was no one better in the country than Andrew Coker. You know, he went back down to the States, played a year at UCSB, then came to McMaster, you know, for the past few years, has really bided his time and waited behind Austin Campion Smith. But this year, he's finally got this team, and, you know, he's made it here to this national final, and that hitting percentage, the way this offense is running, is really a testament to him and his athleticism and skill as a setter.
Yeah, he's probably more of a 1 and a 1A situation when you start comparing setters there between Coker and Walsh, and I'm sure Adam Schreimer would have something to say about it as well on the other side of the net. But, I mean, we're dealing with great players all around here, and Coker and this entire offense is flowing as we see every single McMaster attacker has a point already in this match.
And we talked about the fifth-year Alex Elliott coming in, and then McMaster wanted to get him involved early on, not just their middle involved, but specifically him. He only had 7 kills through the first 2 matches leading into this one. He's got 3 kills already in the first 16 points.
You wonder if that's part of the game plan. You know, if you're Trinity Western, you got to think you got to stop the big guys outside. Maybe opens up a little bit for Elliott, as Demyenko just ripped on that one. Shearhorn out of the pipe, dug up there by Coppers. Coppers wants it back. He's going to go up and swing on it, but he puts it into the net. But a nice dig there from Coppers in the back row on that pipe from Shearhorn.
Yeah, that defense so far for McMaster, that's really been the difference. And they've been transitioning their offense so well, and that's created such a spread in this first set.
Goosen serve, pass backwards there by Youngjevsky. Diving save from McCarthy. Free ball coming here for the Spartans. Bergen there with the pass. Schreimer quickly outside to Slater. Youngjevsky, big dig. Coker goes up high to get it. Tips it over from Elliott there. Bergen, good job to keep it alive. Slater left side. Youngjevsky with the dig. Coker outside to Marr. The ball's inside. He has to just tip it over. Good rally going on here. Schreimer tries to find Betcher on the 60, but McMaster was on the net. Our longest rally so far.
Absolutely, and you know what? This is what the fans came to see here. So far, there's been no hesitation on either side. Sure, Trinity Western isn't hitting at that same clip that they're used to, but they're still going for every ball and making it exciting.
16-9 is the advantage for Mac. Coker bumps it outside. Marr looks to wipe it off the block of Schreimer, and that's exactly what he does. No defense there behind him.
And that's a play where, you know, it's a break for McMaster, because that's a ball that Schreimer would like to have back and just wrap it up. What happened, he turned his shoulders and rotated his left arm off the net, and it gave the advantage to the push inside.
8-point advantage for the Marauders. Coker back to serve. Big spin serve passed up there by Slater. Schreimer up high. And a block from Elliott on Betcher. Trinity thought maybe the block from McMaster on that Schreimer set was over the net, but they don't get the call. Tough to save from our angle here. 18-9 now.
Alex Elliott showing up, already 4 points tonight. He's playing big in his last match ever.
Coker, spin serve into the net, side out, Trinity Western. And you can, if you're Coach Preston, up 18-10, I think you just want your guys to keep being aggressive. You don't mind a mistake like that. Same with when Marr was on the net previously. He's making the right decision, just a little bit too tight on the block. Coach Preston happy with these types of decisions.
This is definitely the most aggressive we've seen McMaster on the service line, and you know what? They're getting rewarded for it.
Schreimer serves, sails long. And Trinity Western, you know, I wouldn't think that they would be too phased by this environment. You know, I think they've played a lot of tough matches, just a little bit off right now. I don't think too much of a nerves. Just misfiring a little bit. Marr from the service line. Schreimer again slips. That's the third time now we've seen him fall when going for a ball. Passes up tight. Coker goes to get it. And that ball goes.
Whoa.
Oh, overruled there. Head official Darius Ilkew. Interesting. It looked like it was in from our side. It looked like there was a little bit of gray there.
I tend to agree.
And based on what you can hear in the background, the McMaster fans do not agree.
You know, you have to understand that you got a local referee. He might call it towards the McMaster Riders on the line, but up referee, I think he made the right call there.
Slater's serve goes long. They get the side out the easy way, 20-11.
Of course, head referee Terrence Ilkew here, non-biased as he is from exactly in between both of these places from Winnipeg. Yeah.
Elliott's jump float, just wide. Mac wanted it. And I look up here, you got somebody at the far wall up at the back there saying, come on, that's in. You don't exactly have the greatest angle.
I can see it from here. That's always the best line.
20-12, Betcher serving. Taken there by Young Jaski. Great pass. Coker piped to Marr. Nobody home. Thank you very much, Stephen Marr.
One of the things here, obviously, McMaster's rule and they're clicking, and it's, Trinity Western hasn't developed any rhythm in their block or their offense. But I think what people have to realize is that, it's a tough environment. That's part of what's going on right now. Trinity Western is not going to get fazed by this. They're going to come back. Don't forget, yesterday they lost pretty big in the first set, 25-18 to Alberta, before coming back to defeat them.
Absolutely. It's just about weathering the storm. Everyone knew that McMaster was going to come out flying. We felt it from the national anthem. So if Trinity Western can kind of gain some momentum here at the end of this first set, they're going to make set number two real interesting.
Coker outside to Coppers. Off the touch. Interesting thing that I've noticed from Ben Josephson, I think it's kind of his style. This entire set, he's just been writing things down just madly in his clipboard. Just this whole time, writing. How can we make adjustments? How can we be better moving forward? And that'll be the hardest part here now as Mac is up 22-13, looking comfortable in this set, right? But how will they adjust to the adjustments from Trinity Western, as teams will always try to come out and do things differently as we go forward? Block there from Shearhorn and Goosen on Demianko.
Great identifying Goosen as Demianko kind of hung back and went for the 61, and Goosen picked up on him and got to the two-man block.
Now it'll be Shearhorn who goes back to serve for Trinity Western. Last night, one of the all-time tournament performances, was just phenomenal for these Spartans. And that one there, Demianko powers it through the block of Goosen. We're now at 23-14 with Demianko going back to serve.
Yeah, and Demianko ripped on a few in the earlier in the set, and that really what created that first spread. Let's see what he does again here.
Guys, interesting, as we've made it now to our third time through, Trinity Western only been able to score 2 points on their serve this whole set. McMaster siding out at an incredible rate. That ball there from Goosen goes off the face of Marr. And Goosen and Marr kind of bump knees a little bit. Got a double whammy there. That one didn't feel too good off the block, and then they kind of bump into each other a little bit. 23-15, and it is Goosen who goes back to serve.
Jared, you mentioned the efficiency of McMaster right now. They're attacking at 46% as a team, 14 kills, only 4 errors.
Yeah, it's incredibly impressive, the attack they've been able to have so far against this big block of Trinity Western. And with that missed serve, we now have a set point opportunity here for the Marauders, 24-15, with Coker going back to the line to try to serve his team into a one-set-to-none lead. And he's been serving very tough as the McMaster faithful come to their feet for this big point. Coker's serve taken there by Spader, off the net. Trimer tries to go back to him there, and a great crafty shot down the line. Coker's gets up saying, I think that one was out.
Absolutely. Maybe, trying a little bit too hard there to make the fantastic dig and get that set point. So you can tell he got up and said right away it's out. We'll see him do better next time.
Again, the fans stay on their feet, and they are giving it to the third-year setter here, Adam Schreimer, who served, taken there by Young Jeffsky. It's tight. Squader goes up to get it. And this set, guys, probably for Mac. But you wonder, points like this kind of at the end here, if you can maybe steal a little bit of momentum, take a little bit of the energy out of the gym with a big kill there from Slater.
Absolutely. Just get a little bit of more wind in your sails as you head to the bench and get ready for that second set.
Tough serve there. Coppers goes to Marr. Marr looks to wipe it off the block, but Slater's there to shut the door. And again, just every point that Trinity scores here, it just brings the gym down just a little tiny bit, and you got to think it makes the start of that second set just a little bit easier and coming out of the gates. But these fans, I can guarantee you, aren't going away. They are still on their feet. The Vuvuzelas are going. Young Jeski, another pass off the net. They go back to Marr, and Marr stuffed there by Slater and Betcher. 24-19. And now Coach Preston will call timeout. And if you're on that Trinity team right now, this is exactly what you needed and wanted.
And I'm sure that Coach Ben Josephson is talking to his team about poise and resilience and those type of factors. Let's not forget, we just mentioned yesterday they lost the first set 25-18 and only attacked at 20% against Alberta. They came back in the second and third sets to attack at over 40% in each of those sets and won each of those sets going into the fourth and eventual fifth. But this is not uncharted waters for Trinity Western. They know where they are. They're now being comfortable in this gym. And McMaster just needs to keep that pressure on Trinity Western.
And guys, let's not forget, they lost the first game of their playoff series to Calgary in that best of three on the road. So that's a hostile environment as well at the Jack in Calgary. They lost that first night, came back, won the second and third to advance in the Canada West Final Four. And then we've talked about many times the upset over the number one seed Alberta Golden Bears in that Canada West semifinal. And then again did it last night to get here today. 24-19, Trimer serve out of the timeout, taken there by Maher off the net. Coker goes back to Stephen Maher. Nice dig there from Shearhorn. Free ball coming here to the Marauders side. Coker to Maher again, and Trimer gets a piece, but not enough. And with that, the Marauders take the opening frame, 25-19, and lead this 50th CIS National Final, one set to none. But maybe, just maybe, Trinity stole some of the momentum at the end of that first set.
They definitely got some of the momentum and confidence back to their side of the court. Good job by Coker to go to Maher to finish off that set. Not just because he's one of your number one gun, but because he's that emotional leader. He comes down and brings that energy right to your side, immediately lifts your side back to where you were and all those points leading up to that.
Guys, we're going to throw it courtside to Amanda Weldon, who's going to speak about one of the big impact players of that opening first set.
Yeah, you want to talk about value. We're looking at Alex Elliott right now. He's got 5 points here up on the record right now. That's huge to classify as a middle. You know, the fact that Andrew Coker has had the ability to really single in on his middles, Danny Demianko, Alex Elliott, is huge. This is especially huge for Alex Elliott himself. This is his fifth year here, which means this will be his last time in the Burridge Gym playing for this team with the program. So this means more than just a CIS final. This means sealing a career on the highest note possible. So with that, I'm going to send it back to you guys on the desk.
Thank you, Amanda. We appreciate that insight. And good job by Amanda. They're dodging that one rogue ball that came flying out of there. Obviously, Amanda, a former volleyball player, maybe herself in her own right down there. But, you know, great point. When you have these fifth-year players, I mean, there's so much more than just the one game, right? It's a culmination of entire career and everything you've done over the course of time in the CIS.
Absolutely, and I mean, what better way to end it than on your final, than on your home court? Win or loss, you know, I'm sure Alex Elliott, this match is going to mean a lot for him, as actually his brother is standing up just opposite from us wearing his number 5. And, you know, he must have a lifetime of memories in this gym and on this floor and with these guys. So what better way to close it out? But I'm sure he'd love to close it out by continuing what they just did and continuing the way he's played. And Dan, I think you've got a few stats for us for here. So what do we got?
Yeah, it was late getting going for Trinity Western in that set. But once they got going, they started to click. And they've got a few kills out of Shearhorn, 2 kills on his 8 attempts. Slater, 2 kills on his 9 attempts. They just need more offensive production. Only 7 kills as a team in that first set. And they started to bring it on late, so I'm sure that they're going to bring that forward into the second set. But McMaster, you can't argue with their offense. Stephen Maher, 6 kills on 11 attempts, only 3 errors. And Coppers, 3 kills on 4 attempts, only 1 error, and getting the middle involved right away. 5 kills between Alex Elliott and Danny Demianko. They're attacking at 35%, and that was the difference in that first set, was their ability to come out of the gates attacking. It took Trinity Western a little bit of time.
As you see on the screen here, some highlights from that first set. And interesting here, guys, have kind of an interesting stat. You know, over the last 5 years, the Marauders in OUA and CIS games are 6-1 in medal games. Right, so interesting, when it's been on the line, you know, in those medal games, they've come through big time. So 6 of these players have been in medal contention games the past 4 years. I mean, they're used to these situations here, and now it's just a matter of, can they win the big one? Can they win the one they really want? And as much as I'm sure they're very proud of the success they've had in the OUA, you know, making the final a handful of years ago, I see I got a couple bronze medals in there. They want the gold. That's what this is all about. You work all year for that gold medal, and they're one step closer after winning that first set there against this Spartans team.
Yeah, you know, talking to these guys at the beginning of the season, Absolutely. They talked about just taking it one game at a time, but you could tell all of them had their eyes on this national final. Like we've said before, they were the only team in the country that knew when they would be playing on Thursday night in that first set, indicative of that. But it'll be interesting to see, watching Trinity Western walk by, there was no worry, there was no panic. They seemed calm, cool, and collected, and they seem to be doing pretty well in this first set, or second set.
Yeah, a good job there from Marr off the top of the block. Kozlowski got a piece in the back row, but not enough. Just too much power from Stephen Marr. So now it's Demianko who goes back to serve for McMaster, his fourth-year player here, and that one had some pace on it, and then some confusion between Proctis and Slater. Slater kind of telling Proctis, you go for it. I think Proctis kind of thought he was going to go for it, but they're sorting it out now. I don't know if that ball had more than one rotation, guys, off the hands of Demianko. It kind of came flying right at Kozlowski. Very difficult to handle with that much pace. Another tough serve taken there by Shearhorn. Outside to Slater. Slater down the line. Great shot there, Ryan Slater.
Excellent shot. Just a little bit of a delay before he swung, but he was able to find the line and the court.
That's exactly the type of swing you want if you're Ben Josephson from Ryan Sclater. You know, kind of a quiet set, only two kills in the first, and comes out early, swings a nice one down the line, past the block, and past McCarthy.
Tough serve there from Goosen, taken by Coppers. Coppers out of the back row, looks for the hands. I think just a little bit, and as much as the man in the back row that saw that ball in the corner first set, looking for the touch up there, the ref doesn't believe him.
What I notice is Trinity Western's relaxed on their block a little bit. They're starting to catch up. They're not as late as they were in the first set.
Goosen serve taken there by Youngjevsky. Coker all the way outside to Marr, and Marr powers it through the block. You know, guys, after we see that great set there from Coker, you know, he had 83 assists, 13.83 assists per set in this championship, which is first, and 10 digs, and he's only had one ball handling error this whole tournament. And I really think, you know, as great as Brett Walsh is, and that's very, very much the case, he's got somebody probably nipping on his heels in the future here with Andrew Coker, as Shearhorn squeezes that one through Marr and down. And, you know, if you're the Spartans, you got to get Shearhorn going. Last night, Shearhorn and Slater were almost the entire offense for this Spartans team. And Shearhorn, Dan, what were his numbers in that first set there compared to what we saw yesterday?
Yeah, only attacking at 12.5% efficiency, making two kills on one attempt. He had only three errors yesterday and 25 kills.
Middle to Elliott. Betcher gets a piece. Back on the McMaster side, outside to McCarthy. McCarthy with the tip. Betcher goes way up high to put that tip back to the Mac side. Continue now. Marr with the roll shot. Kozlowski, great job. Coming back with the set. Slater into the soft block. Shearhorn keeps it alive. Slater's going to go by again. And again, it goes back to the Spartan side. Great rally here early on in this second set. Schreimer sets tight. Got to go try and tip it over. But the McMaster block just too big on that one. But good job defensively by the Spartans to try to recycle some of those attacks.
Yeah, Trinity Western and Slater in particular doing really well at recycling and recycling. And finally, that out-of-system set just a little too tight, and the Marauders throw it down.
I'm not sure if there's a better setting libero in the country than Kozlowski. He just lives for those moments, as we see him with a great pass there. And now Schreimer with the ball handling ovation. That's two we've seen now early on in this match.
Absolutely. And we've seen how they put the whistles away, but the only two Schreimer's had have been pretty bad. But going back to Kozlowski's setting, the only libero I've really seen upset this way goes by the name of Sergio.
Yeah, he's all right. Not a bad guy to model your game after. Big serve there from Marr. High ball outside to Plotkis. Got to bump into each other. Could only just tip it over. And Youngjevsky saying, hey, Kozlowski, anything you can do, I can do just as well. Good job there finding Marr on the pipe. 6-4 Mac.
You know what? As much as I like Youngjevsky, he doesn't exactly have Kozlowski style, but give him full credit. That was a great set in that situation.
You don't like the ponytail, or you mean the volleyball style?
The volleyball style. Not saying, you know, Powell it doesn't have a style of his own, but Kozlowski does have a certain panache.
Stephen Marr.
Despite having four guys on serve receive, dropping Blockus back to pass, it's just too much power on that serve.
Yeah, you're basically standing on the end line on this serve, and it's still giving them troubles, the four guys across. Marr comes back with the soft one, and that was so close to working. And what a brilliant adjustment there from Marr. He sees how deep they are on the receive, and we're talking about inches there on that being an ace.
And he's just having a chuckle about it with Coach Dave Fresson there. They both knew a millimeter more, maybe a centimeter, and that one rolls over.
Slater serve, taken there by Marr. Coker back to McCarthy, looks for the roll shot. He's very close to hitting the aerial. Play continues on the Spartan side, and Shearhorn off the block to McCarthy and down. And, you know, guys, we've been to the last couple nationals. We've seen McMaster here, you know, on the webcast and, you know, in these games. Does Coach Preston look like a lot more confident and kind of just relaxed in these situations than he is before? It's almost like, you know, and it breathes through the whole team. You know, they're very, you know, I think probably some of it comes with being at home, how comfortable they are in this situation, but nothing seems to be phasing this MAC team this tournament.
You know, I heard a great line from Coach Preston last night as he was talking to a few OVA coaches, and he goes, you know, they call us head coaches for a reason. It's because we coach the head. And I think that's what he's demonstrating here. You know, he wants his team to stay calm, cool, and collected. He knows they play emotionally, so if he's emotional on the sideline and getting jacked up, the team is going to emulate that. So it's his job to stay calm and even keel, even though the team is amped up.
Well, it's very easy to be confident in your team when you have a guy like Stephen Marr coming out of the back row on that pipe. And, you know, guys, I'm just going to give a quick shout out here. My cousin, he's just a youngster. He's getting into volleyball, grade six. He was watching yesterday. Lachlan, he calls Marr the beast. He said the beast just can't be stopped. And I think Lachlan hit the nail on the head with that one, as Kozlowski does a great job keeping that alive. And now Schreimer. I don't know what he's thinking there. That's got to be your ball. You know Shearhorn wants to go out and hit. And now we're going to have a timeout from Coach Josephson. He's not happy, and rightfully so.
Well, I think the key is that he's had a number of errors from Adam Schreimer, both in ball handling and then going after some balls. A lot of communication errors on the court, too. And that can happen when you're in a loud environment, unfamiliar and hostile. But you want to settle down, and that's what he's doing right now to the guys. He's just telling them, let's play our game. Let's relax. They're a team that relies on that strong communication, good execution.
Guys, we see on the replay here, Schreimer just having some confusion on that play. Not quite sure what he heard or saw, but again, with so many people here in this gym, you know, he could have heard something, and I really like the direction that Coach Josephson took in that timeout. Literally brought the guys together. He was the one who was had his arms around everyone in that huddle, and you could tell, very animated in that huddle. And I think he's saying, guys, you know, we're not playing our best here. Right, we're not getting beat because the other teams, but we're the ones who are struggling here. And obviously, I mean, McMaster is playing very well, but I think he feels like his guys have a lot more to give here as that serve goes long.
And that's not what you want to see from the Rodders. You come back after a timeout, and Trinity Western makes that weird play, and you know, you just want to put that ball in right away and put the ball in their hands and make them make a play.
Betcher now back to serve. A very difficult jump float. Young Jaski did a good job getting out in the air. Demianko finds the end line. Nice swing there from Danny Demianko.
Yeah, and he's been dynamite all game long, and we're used to seeing him bounce them in the middle, but that time going long right in that 5-6 seam, as we see here on the replay, right over top of the blockers, and no chance for the defense.
McCarthy now back to serve. 10-8 McMaster, and McCarthy serve. It was trying to get into that corner, but just long, and now we will see coming into the game, Carter Bergen, and I think Carter deserves some credit. He's really done a great job for this Trinity Western team all weekend long, coming off the bench. He takes out Ploctis, and then we'll see Kozlowski line up in one, and it allows them to have two just unbelievable defenders in the two corner spots in the back row, but Bergen's serve goes long, very close, just missed.
Yeah, the Trinity Western fans who are sitting right on that sideline are definitely seeing otherwise, but the McMaster fans right behind them are definitely contesting that call.
The human brain is a funny thing. Your eyes and your head and your heart, when they all get connected, they can play tricks on you. And you know, when you have if you have an allegiance to one team, it's hard sometimes to see things the right way. The officials were right on it, but it was very close.
Unfortunately, this isn't the police league. We don't have a challenge system just yet.
Shearhorn serve off the arm of Coppers. Coppers kind of jumped in front of Young Jieski there. And we're going to see a substitution we saw yesterday as well. Richards coming into the back row here, giving Coppers a breather. And we, you know, talked about him being the junior national team libero. This is a great guy to bring off the bench and give you some energy. And it's not like he's not an offensive player either. He can hit that pipe out of the back row in transition here. They go right after Richards. Pass off the net. Coker to Marr.
We talked about the effectiveness of the float serve, and that's why they have to make that substitution on reception to really get a better contact on the float serve. This gym is very unique, and we talked about the shape of it and the air currents, and we can feel it as we sit courtside here. You can feel that air blowing down over your shoulder onto the court. It really does influence the float serve, and we've seen a lot of float servers miss because of it throughout this tournament, and a lot of coaches talk about it. And we've also seen a lot of float serves that have created a lot of difficulty for passers because of it when they can be kept in the court. But I think both teams now have missed somewhere around 16 total serves in two sets. That's a lot.
Guys, McMaster has 22 total kills in this match, and 12 of them are from Marr. So they're definitely feeding the beast, and the big man is handling the workload there as we see a kill from McCarthy.
Yeah, we haven't seen McCarthy swing on too many balls. He got that early kill in the first set, and pretty quiet since then, only his second kill.
I think the national team really looks forward to seeing Marr and Shearhorn on the same team in the future. Two real great prospects on the left side as Betcher's attack finds the sideline. And I think this is another young player with a lot of potential, Aaron Betcher. Again, we saw him at the club level a couple years ago back in Edmonton at Nationals, and he just continues to improve every time that I see him.
Yeah, one of the youngest players on the floor all throughout the weekend, only in his second year, but he's done a great job. He's a very athletic middle, and you know, this is a great opportunity for him to learn in this environment.
Schreimer's jump float taken there by Young Jaski. Coker back to Marr, off the hands of Slater and Long. Stephen Marr is rolling, 14-13.
My camera guy, Evan, had to duck real quick there. Hopefully that's a nice clip for the Volleyball Source highlight reel afterwards.
He's in a good spot down there. And it's a fantastic beard on him too. I've got to give him some credit for that.
That's due to a bet. Okay. He can shave it on April 1st.
Fair enough. On the back set there, Alex Elliott finds the soft spot in the Trinity Western defense. 15-13 Mac, but a much more competitive set here in the second than we saw in the first.
Yeah, absolutely. Trinity Western just, you know, they had to weather that storm. You knew Mac was going to come out strong. They did. Now Trinity Western's here to play.
Marr, pass there by Slater. Schreimer goes all the way back. That ball had a lot of spin. The fans were looking for a call, but play continues. Schreimer back to Slater again. And this one goes off the block, and yes, that ball can't be played as it went onto this side of the court.
I still appreciate the effort when they go
absolutely.
Chase that ball down.
Absolutely.
Although, off of a block, a ball can never be played when it goes to the other side of the court, yet you see players go after it repeatedly. It's good effort, and it shows your hustle and your mentality that nothing's going to drop, but it is impossible to ever retrieve a block that goes on the other side of the court.
Yes, well, you never know if the ref's paying attention. Might as well go for it.
Yeah, that might maybe work in like a junior high tournament or something, I guess, if you go to chase it down. But Terrace Ilkew on the stand here, the Winnipeg referee. As soon as that ball was touched, immediately blew it dead. We're still 1 point away from the technical timeout. 16-14 is the score. McMaster on top. And Slater's serve. That was a rocket pass tight, and not much Coker can really do there. Shearhorn puts it down, and Trinity Western just continues to plot their way through this set here. Everybody in this gym, except for about 15 people in the corner, seem to be against them. That's a feeling I certainly can appreciate from my past experiences, and it's a tough spot to be in, and I think Trinity has handled it very well to this point. Ball's passed over the net. Shearhorn takes the free ball. They go pipe to Slater, and that ball's off the touch, and that gets the Trinity Western bench up, and they seem to be playing with a new level of confidence now, leading 16-15, as we see on the replay here. The great set to Slater coming in and off the shoulder of Coker. And this is maybe one of the few leads Trinity Western's had all day.
Yeah, I think this is the first time they've led in this match at all. And we see Slater really heating up. He only got 2 kills, 2 points in the first set, now sitting with 6. So 4 points already in this set. And we saw Coker there a little out of position, and he gets a hit off the shoulder.
I was going to say, you're seeing a lot of energy from Slater here. After that big serve that was overpassed, he was yelling right away that he wanted that ball on offense. Came flying in against the one-on-one block situation and got the tool. But he's definitely a player to watch moving forward in this match as we try and build rhythm, as Adam Schreimer tries to build rhythm with his offense. He's got to try and find that guy that's going to be the go-to. He might balance it out, you know, as he goes, but it was Shearhorn yesterday. Maybe it's going to be Slater today.
Yeah, we see Shearhorn has 7 points and Slater has 6. But Shearhorn definitely not getting the same volume that he got yesterday against Alberta. If you're McMaster, I think you're pretty happy that he's not yet in that same rhythm as he was last night. I think at any moment's notice, he can really get it going. As on the service line is Slater after the timeout taken by Young Jeske. to Richards, dug up there by Slater. High ball way up in the air to Shearhorn, and it goes off the top of the hands of Elliott and down. And I'm curious if we're going to see the return of Copper soon, potentially, or if Coach Preston is going to continue to stick with Richards as he's now come to the front row.
Now, Richards can play in the front row with these guys. He's a little undersized at about 6'3", maybe 6'4", but, you know, he's a crafty player. He's a beach player. He knows how to score regardless of being a little less physically dominant.
McCarthy on the right, down the line, dug up there by Kozlowski, and McCarthy does a great job. That's a really smart play there. He went up, kind of put his arms back so that he for sure wouldn't be over the net. It did touch him. It went back down, but that's totally legal. So many players are going to get over-anxious and want to reach over and hit that ball down.
And a great dig by Kozlowski, though. There wasn't much line to hit at, and he still made a quick move into the court to dig the ball. It was a hit about a meter and a half in the court.
Schreimer really leading Betcher there on that attack. He's able to just tip it over. Richards looks for the wipe. Oh. They're going to call a carry ball on that one. And Coach Preston, I think, agrees with the call.
No protest by Richards, but his teammates were all over it.
The fans didn't like it. The 2,000 other referees, as we see the replay there, the 2,000 other referees in the building didn't like the call. Betcher's jump float, taken by Young Jeske. Coker goes middle to Demianenko, and that's one of the best hits we've seen all day.
Wow, and that's just a testament to how athletic Demianenko is. I mean, that pass was shot to Coker. He had to jump up nice and quick to cut that off, and Demianenko is up like a spring to put that down quickly. Wow.
And guys, in the tournament, he has 3.17 kills per set, which ranks 11th of all players competing. But he has a 5.33 hitting percentage, which is second overall. So it's really not that unexpected that you see an attack like that from Danny Demianenko. Kozlowski, high ball outside to Shearhorn, tipped down the line. McCarthy's there to keep it alive. Coker goes pipe to Marr. I think that ball is going to be a little bit too quick, a little bit too low for Marr. Attack goes into the net.
Yeah, great play to adjust and take out the C-ball option because on that last play, Shearhorn was allowed to go right over to the pipe and seal it up. He gave no look to position five on the pipe attack simply because he took out the right side.
Ball just serving for the Spartans, taken there by Marr. Coker, high ball to Richards, and Richards dug up there by Antoniak, who subbed into the back row for the Spartans. Free ball here for McMaster. They go middle to Demianenko. Antoniak with another dig. Schreimer goes on that pipe to Slater, and Marr can't get enough. And that was a great run. He kind of faked like he was going to go on the slide play to Goosen. He was moving around, but he ends up setting Slater instead. And that's very tough for the blockers to pick up with. 20-17 now is the score for Trinity Western. Coach Preston calls timeout.
Well, in that first set, we said that Trinity Western has been here before and that they weren't going to get phased. So sure enough, here we are in the second set, and after attacking less than 20% in the first set, they are now attacking at 53% in this set. 10 kills on 17 attempts with just one error, whereas McMaster, even though they're attacking really well, 12 kills, 3 errors on 24 attempts for 38% efficiency, we're just seeing a new Trinity Western team out here.
Yeah, absolutely, and it's similar storyline to last night as well. You know, Alberta came out flying right out of the gate, and they were pretty strong in the beginning of the second set. Trinity Western slowly took over. Now we'll see if Matt can make a few big plays here to get the crowd back into what we saw last night with that, you know, 4-point deficit. It was down 21-17 last night against Saskatchewan, and they came back, so here we go.
Clock just jump float taken by Richards, pass off the net. Coker goes back to McCarthy, and McCarthy off the block of Shearhorn and Goosen, and side out for McMaster.
Exactly what McMaster needed, because you got your defensive specialist more or less, and Richards heading back to the back row, and you know he's got a difficult spin serve to deal with, and more importantly, Stephen Marr comes to the front.
Richards serve under the arms of Shearhorn. Schreimer goes quickly back to him on the left, hits that ball into a spot where it's just so hard to defend when you can get at that angle.
What's a creative attack too. Against the two-man block, Shearhorn has typically gone down the line and looked for the line tool, and there he just cut it off real quick cross-court by the two blockers.
Coker back row to McCarthy again, and this time that ball's hit long. And you know, Dan, I ask you, you know, in your time in university and coaching and being involved, have you ever seen a prospect similar to Blake Shearhorn in our country?
you know, it's tough to say that he's so young too, right? He's got so much more time, but yeah, I think he's definitely a huge prospect for our country. He's got all the top end, right? And you know, there's a lot of part of the game that has to be built into there, and there's a big difference between what we're doing here and what we're doing at the international level. But he's got the tools in his tool belt, and he's showing that he can use them in this situation.
Well, I think what's really interesting is, you know, can't forget is last season he was an opposite player, right? He was lined up on the right side, and this took a little more to the left, and you know, passing and obviously a little more defensive responsibilities than what he's been used to, and it doesn't seem to be too much of a factor. I think it's obviously still a work in progress, but I mean, just physically, I can't think of somebody similar to him. I'm not saying he's the best player I've ever seen in CIS, but just his body type and, you know, the physicality and the athleticism, he's in a class. I can't think of too many other guys, CIS on the left side, like Blake Shearhorn.
No, definitely no one plays at the height he does in the country right now.
Coker all the outside to Marr. Marr down the line, dug up there by Kozlowski. Antoniak bump set outside to Slater. Slater off the top of the block. Richards with the save. Coker middle to Demianko. Antoniak with a piece. Slater, a great job to save it. What a good job on the defensive side here for the Spartans. Coker middle to Demianko again, and Antoniak again gets a piece. But he kind of dug it back into himself a little bit there and took some of the pace off of it. The Spartans can't keep it alive.
Yeah, that double libero situation right now for Trinity Western paying dividends. When you've got two guys on the wings who can play good defense and make good digs like that, you're going to keep a lot of plays alive.
Schreimer off the net, goes back over to Shearhorn, dug up there by McCarthy, ball goes back to the Spartan side, and some confusion here, but Marv's going to have a chance to swing on it, and Antonio gets a piece, but not enough, and you see Josephson turning to his team and saying, guys, go for the ball, and that's, you know, that's the type of play that they've had in these games. They've been successful, the ball hasn't the floor, they've had a couple slip on this side now.
And it's a situation there as we have a timeout called by Coach Josephson that, you know, you question, you know, why didn't they have three blockers up in that situation? I think they didn't think that Coker was going to get the ball up to Mark in a position to attack, you know, and they only had two guys up, three guys up, they would have stopped that ball.
You know, we mentioned it just before in the last time out of how McMaster was in the same spot last night. They were down late in the set, and, you know, it was just one or two plays that got the crowd into it, and that was a big play right there that got the crowd up on their feet.
It's getting the McMaster crowd, like you said, back into it, which is not what you want to do if you're Trinity West. I mean, if you have them down a little bit, have them a little bit quiet, you got to do everything you can to try and keep them out of it. That's Coach Josephson's second and final timeout. Remember, he called one fairly early in this set, and that was a bit of a difference maker as they started to battle back, and now eventually have taken a 22-20 lead as McMaster will do what they can to try to get this back to even here. They still trail by two, 22-21 the first set. They want to try and take that two set to none lead, which is so important in our game. Slater, left side. Damianko got a piece. McCarthy's going to try to chase it down, but it goes into the crowd. 23-20 as Betcher will check back in for Antoniak.
As you mentioned there, Jared, Danny Damianko got a piece of that, and it still went that hard through. That says a lot about the height and the speed and the power of that attack.
Yeah, Ryan Slater's kind of looked like a man possessed since that first set on service eve as well. He's been dialed in.
Goosen serve, and some confusion between Richards and Jędrzejewski. I think Richards kind of bailed out a little bit on Jędrzejewski there as he looked kind of confused that Richards wasn't taking it. And we now have set point opportunity for Trinity Western, 24-20.
And you know what, we said it at the end of the first set. Trinity Western was nowhere near down and out. They've shown it here.
And it looks like that'll be an ace for the Spartans, and they take the second set. 25-20, and we are all even up at one set apiece. And if anybody in this building thought that either of these teams was going to win three straight, that'd be bad money, as these two teams are just way too close. And five sets has kind of been, you know, not sure who's going to be, but you got to think five sets is probably a pretty safe bet. We have Amanda Weldon with us on courtside, and we'll send it over to you, Amanda. Thank you.
Definitely, we're watching two of the very best teams in Canada right now, and there's no doubt that this is the best volleyball that we're seeing. Looking from a MAC perspective, we're seeing a lot of really great things coming from the middle. The fact that Andrew Coker has been able to isolate that middle, Danny Damianko sending him back time and time again, just goes to show that they're really trying to move those blockers on the other side. In terms of the Trinity Western side, the fact that they're really getting Shearhorn and Slater back in there, you know, they're back on that stat board, they're back involved, that gave them a lot of success. This set versus the last set. You know, there's a lot of height on both sides. Both matchups are pretty big right now, and we're seeing a lot of great things coming from both sides, but the fact that there's a lot of missed serves, a couple of unforced errors, and Shearhorn and Slater are back in there, it's making a very big difference. So we're going to hit it back to you guys at the desk.
Thank you, Amanda, as always, and as we head back here into the booth, Dan, obviously Dave Preston, but the head coach with McMaster now, for a handful of years, what can you tell him about, tell us about him?
Dave Preston, obviously the head coach of this McMaster team, and a good statement by Everett yesterday. What does that actually mean? Well, he coaches the head real well. But Dave Preston, of course, he's got a 30-19 playoff record, a 225 wins and 74 losses overall record. He led the team to the OUA Final Four for the title past 4 years. He's got a very successful program. He should be very proud of his program, and he's dialed in and focused for this match today. He really, really wants this gold medal for his team, for the OUA, right, and for the history log of his program.
And Everett, Ben Josephson, the head coach of Trinity Western, what do you know about him?
You know, Ben Josephson, he's been there at Trinity Western for 9 years, has really established the Spartans as maybe one of the top programs in the country. I mean, gold in 2011 and 2012. We've talked about that team before, quite possibly one of the best Canadian CIS teams of all time. Silver in 2010 and again last year in 2015. Six straight CIS championships, six straight CIS championship appearances for the Spartans, and that's all due to Coach Ben Josephson.
Yeah, and he's been with Trinity Western for a long time, an assistant coach and player before that, so he's literally been with probably Trinity Western almost half his life. And you know, interesting, I was chatting with him this morning, and I said, you know what, this is the third time I've worked a CIS national championship, and all three times I've been here, Trinity Western's made the final. So I guess maybe he's happy to see me here on the announcing booth. And you know, Dan, you want to give us a quick rundown of those stats after two sets?
Well, one very interesting stat to look at right away. After the first set of volleyball, Trinity Western had five total blocks, while McMaster had one total block. That hasn't changed too much. Trinity Western went that whole set without getting another block in the second set. They're still at five total blocks, and McMaster only added one. What does that tell us? It tells us that this CIS game is about attackers adjusting to blockers. The best attackers should beat the best blockers in volleyball, and that's what we're seeing right now from both these teams making adjustments on offense.
And I think we're going to need to really see a response from McMaster, right? This is the first set they've lost this tournament. 3-0 against Waterloo, 3-0 against Saskatchewan. And how do they handle losing a set and now being tied up at one set apiece? It's outside Tamar. I think that's a good response. That's how you handle it. Give it to the big man and let him do his job.
You know, we were talking about the blockers just before, and I think that's indicative of how these teams use their blocking. You know, if they're not going out there to get points, it's really to take away an area court and let the defense set up around it.
Demianko back to serve. Passed up there by Shearhorn. That was a bullet. Slater continues to have himself a great game.
And let's not ignore the fact that was an amazing set by Kozlowski. The height and location inside and tight enough to the net so that he could still go up and hit cross court on that block was incredible.
Not to mention the amount of spin that was on the ball, and that came out perfectly clean.
Elliott's attack into the block, but kept alive here by Mack. Coppers out of the back row. Deck up there by Shearhorn. Schreimer goes back to him on the right. McCarthy with a nice dig. But it's just going to be a free ball coming back to the Trinity Western side. They try and put it short in there, and it works as it pulls Schreimer off the net. And then Slater misses that attack wide down the line. We're tied up at two.
Dave Preston really happy with his team's discipline there, and I think that's what they want to do. They want to give Slater about a ball and a half, maybe two balls a line to hit at, and see how well he can pinpoint the sideline, because he missed on that one, and Dave seemed pretty happy with the block alignment.
Coker now back to serve. Tied up at two, and we're tied up at one set apiece. I think if you're McMaster, if you continue to serve at Shearhorn and really make him work hard, it's going to be something interesting strategy. Obviously, I think you want to keep the ball off Kozlowski as much as possible.
Absolutely. You know, Kozlowski's going to dime you every single time, but if you go at Shearhorn, every serve that goes at him, it just adds pressure, it adds stress, you know, takes energy away from him. And if this match ends up going five, if he's passed every single ball, then, you know, it's going to be that much more difficult for him to jump and get up to those other ones.
Great set there from Coker to Elliott. And then see if Trinity Western get the ball to that, and they almost do. That's as close as you can get it without it getting over. A great attempt there from Adam Schreimer. Oh, that was close, guys.
That was, you know what? centimeters away, maybe 1 centimeter higher, and that one rolls over. And there wasn't really a marauder around to take that ball either. My bet it was would have rolled over and scored.
I agree with you. Mar, left side. Serve goes long.
Yeah. You could tell he's not happy with his toss there.
Early into the second set, or third set here, just want to reference that second set in terms of attack efficiencies. What a great job by Trinity Western to come back and have 12 kills and only one error for 50% attack efficiency.
Slater serve taken by Young Jesse. Coker back to McCarthy, and McCarthy finds the sideline. The big lefty, great shot, cross court.
Yeah, he goes over top, and he's been hot and cold a little in this match, but great swing cross court and paints the tee there.
And now it's Elliott who goes back to serve. And Elliott was a huge force in that first set. Didn't hear as much from him in the second. Let's see if they can get him going again as he puts in a tough serve. Clock just tipped it over, takes Coker out of the play. Elliott's going to set a high ball outside to McCarthy. McCarthy off the hands and down. And you know, Jason McCarthy, I feel like, is a player who, you know, he hasn't been a huge factor offensively the first two games. And I wonder if they're able to get him going, what that is going to do against this Trinity Western block.
You know, much like many of these guys on the floor, he has that ability to, you know, go off and really take over a game. But most of the time, these Marauders don't really need that ability from him. So you see him rather, you know, with some strong blocking and some good out-of-system play. Not so much strong blocking out of that one as he seemed to misread it, but he gets a little lucky as Slater puts it out. Shearhorn puts it out.
Yeah, you see McCarthy come down there, not kind of apologizing to his team. He's not happy with his block, but he was saved as Shearhorn hit that ball out of bounds. Copper's getting a chance on the over bump. And we're going to have a net violation on the Spartans. It's, again, we've discussed this throughout the tournament. It's, you know, kind of seems to be the trend here when you have such close teams. But the ebbs and flows and the back and forth and the taking of the momentum between the, you know, these top teams here. And really nobody's been able to establish you know, a consistent dominant performance. These teams are just so good. They're going to come back and forth at each other here like two heavyweights going in a 12-round battle as McCarthy is really starting to heat up. That's three kills in a row in his last three swings.
Yeah.
And the outsides for McMaster really doing a great job. Stephen Marr, 15 kills and four errors, and McCarthy with his seventh kill now of the match and only one error. Really high efficiency from the left side.
And I'm sure this is part of the game plan here from the McMaster coaching staff. As they're telling Coker, we feel like we can use him more. Now McCarthy with the dig. They force the middle to Demianko, and a great run there as Betcher can't catch up with it. And we're going to see a timeout from Coach Josephson.
And you know what, Dan? You just brought up how well they've been using their outsides. You saw at the beginning of the first set, they were going to Demianko, they were going to Ellie in the middle. And I was just about to say, I wonder when Coker's going to go back to going to the middle, and we see it there.
Right, it was no difference yesterday against Saskatchewan. Late in the second set, Saskatchewan was keeping it close, and there, we had mentioned on the broadcast that, you know, it's just a matter of time before Coker started to go back to his middles and start to force them, create the attention there. And he recognized right now he's got good production from his outsides, and, you know, now is the time. Just, you know, get him back in the middle, make that middle blocker hold. And great job by Coker to play with the blocking arrangement of Trinity Western, play with their mind, make sure that they can't stay in release.
Now, speaking to McMaster assistant coach Nathan Jansen before the match, and we're just talking about Steve Brinkman's involvement with this McMaster program, and, you know, he said the guys just, they love it. They love it. He's at practice, and, you know, the middle players especially just soak up all of that knowledge of him, one of, you know, the top middles for our country in the last 10 or 15 seasons, really international play. And, you know, Demianko was a pretty fine middle in his own right before this season, but having somebody like Brinkman working with him can just pay off huge dividends as Elliott's going to go back set to Coppers, and Coppers closes his eyes and swings away, and he gets a fortunate swing there. And that's a great lesson to young players. Just go out, swing high and hard, and good things will happen.
You know, we've seen Coppers just kind of chip a few balls and be a little cute, and that one, he just swings the way off the arms of Betcher, out of bounds.
Shearhorn with the pass to go back to him on the left. Soft block, but Clock is there. What a great scoop dig there from Coker. It's going to be a big rally here. Slater, another dig from Coker. Back to the Trinity Western side. Schreimer goes middle to Betry. Tips it over. Get a piece. Coker with his third dig in the rally. Unbelievable defense here from the center. They go pipe to Slater again.
Oh.
And Elliott got a piece, but not enough. But Coach Preston applauds his team. Those are the type of points that you're proud of even though you lose. And the fans are now on their feet.
And this is the top two teams in the CIS going at it. And that rally just explains why the persistence and heart on discipline to keep it going. And then execution. Kozlowski back set to the pipe.
Yeah,
unbelievable.
I was wondering when we were going to see that back step to the pipe. I've seen it so many times on live streams and haven't really seen it out here this weekend, but finally gets in there as McCarthy wipes that one off the block.
McCarthy is doing his best to be the man of the match here. He's going off. That's four kills now in a row for him on the right side, and he goes back to serve with his team leading 11-5. Oh, the energy here, guys, is just awesome. I hope everybody at home can feel how exciting it is to be here. As that serve from McCarthy goes long. You know, I think we look back to 2013 in Laval, and you know how big that crowd was there for that team. But you know, the thing about the in Laval is it's, I think, a lot more open air and a lot more open space in their venue. You know, this is still a big place, but the fans are kind of right on you. You know, it's hot in here, it's loud, and almost everybody is wearing maroon as Demianko's tip just gets over. Kozlowski bumps it outside to Shearhorn. Shearhorn with the roll shot. McCarthy almost got there, but it just touched the floor. And Shearhorn is so effective on those off-speed shots because it's such a different angle than the defenders are used to seeing.
Right, and the defenders have to stay so deep for the shot that hits the block and deflects outside the court, right? So he throws in the short shot, and it works so well.
Bergen with the serve, just subbed in. Coker outside to Coppers, and Coppers off the outside hand of Schreimer and out of bounds. Nice swing there from the third year left side, Brandon Coppers.
You see Tyler Kozlowski and Schreimer maybe hoping for a touch off Coppers as that went out of bounds, but they looked to Dave Preston. Dave Preston said it was all good. And I like to see that respect between the players on the other side of the net.
Coppers serve, taken there by Kozlowski, outside to Shearhorn, and Shearhorn off the block and down. And he continues to hit these shots that are just so impressive.
Yeah, I don't know how many other people in the world could make that shot. That was a tough angle.
Certainly not too many 21-year-olds.
Nope.
Shearhorn's jump float taken there by Coppers. And go back to McCarthy, and that's the first error we've seen from McCarthy in Alana, only his second of the match.
Yeah, no, and Trinity Western starting to claw back a little bit here. A few big plays, and they cut that lead down to just three.
Shearhorn still serving, jump float, and that really handcuffs Coppers. Jędrzejewski puts it way up in the air. Can they do anything with it? And no, they can't. Great effort to track that one down, but just a little bit wayward and went into the court.
You know, it's interesting because Brandon Coppers hasn't really played for about 4 months leading up to this tournament, so he's probably still getting back into things here, and we've seen that in his serve receive.
That ball was intended for Marr, but Demianko was so high that he actually got a piece of it. And now Coach Preston will call timeout after that kill from the Spartans. It's just a one-point ball game.
Yeah, and you know, we've seen Trinity Western. They've battled back a little. There was a point where it was 10-4 in this game, and now 12-1 as Sklater and Shearhorn have really started putting some points up on the board. And, you know, we've seen McCarthy cool off, and we haven't seen Marr swing on a ball recently.
And, you know, we look at some of the statistics, and you know, Trinity Western has 6 kills and only 2 errors. You think, well, that's pretty good, but they're only attacking at 24% efficiency, and that's by virtue of McMaster playing such great defense on their side of the court, extending a lot of the rallies, whereas McMaster's attacking at 64%, 10 kills, 1 error, but they've only had 14 attempts on offense. So really, McMaster doing a great job on defense, and defense has kept them not only in this match, but given them the lead in this match. It's just a matter of can they keep that going on defense, turn it into offense, and extend their lead, because right now, as mentioned, Trinity Western's bringing it on from their outsides with the attacking and a high efficiency.
12-11, McMaster still leading. They just called timeout, see if they can get a big side out here to slow the momentum on the Spartans. Marr down the line, chips it off the block, kept alive. Schreimer looks for sort of a set dump, but it's blocked there by Marr. Now McMaster's going to have a chance to side out here. McCarthy out of the back row. Great dig there by Kozlowski. Playing to one. Pipe to Shearhorn. And it's a little bit out of position on that one there. Puts that one into the net.
Yeah, it seemed like his approach, he didn't come all the way around. He was kind of facing the outside of the court. We see him slip coming down. Hopefully he's not too hurt from that one.
And now Demianko goes back to serve. 13-11 McMaster. And that one, a little bit mishit, but still in. Kozlowski has to take it. Sklater misses the block and long. 14-11.
And that's exactly what Denny Nagel wants to do right now. He just wants to go back there, put the ball in, and put pressure on Trinity Western. You know, he wants them to make plays. If you're going to beat the McMaster Marauders, you're going to have to straight up beat them.
Demianko gets all of that one. Schreimer goes back to Goosen on the slide. And Mar is not happy with himself there, but, you know, it's a tough spot to be in. That's where that run's so effective.
Well, what a great pass by Carter Bergen as he dropped to the ground to get that ball. That was a serve that, you know, most of the time I think is an ace.
Once again, the benefits of having that double libero situation in the back row for Trinity Western. And interestingly enough, you saw Dave Crescent turn to his bench and go, hey, that's one. They haven't really done it, so why let's not watch for it, but let's keep on monitoring it.
You know, it's funny. A lot of coaches don't like having two liberos on their roster. Sometimes they feel like, you know, maybe they, you know, don't want to take up a spot. You know, Trinity Western has three spots essentially devoted to libero players, and it really works for them, though. When they have Antoniak and Bergen out there, it really solidifies their squad, and that's part of the trade-off. You know, you have some of these bigger left sides with Shearhorn and Slater is bringing these guys in the back row to solidify your serve, receive, and defense. As Marr squeezes that one through the block of Schreimer and down. And with that, we head to the technical timeout with the Marauders leading 16-12.
One thing that I noticed that McMaster is doing real well is that when they run in transition and they go fast to the net, Croker's doing a good job giving the ball to his offense. But more importantly, those guys are making a great decision with the attack based on whether or not the block is there, set, or whether they're going to be penetrated or late. So you see them sometimes hitting high off the hands or hard angles when the block is set and there. But when the block is late, you see them often just hitting those quick shots low into the hand and meeting them. Right? Yeah. So it's a really good, deep, disciplined attack from the outsides to be able to identify where the blocker is and how much time you have to attack against them.
Absolutely. We saw it just there. Schreimer was reaching up rather than over, and Stephen Marr spots that. Nice little chizzy, and it waterfalls on Schreimer.
Guys, just want to take this opportunity now as we're at the timeout to give special thanks to our webcast partner, McMaster University Center for Continuing Education. They're helping make this possible here this weekend, and there's so many people behind the scenes. I think I want to make mention of that as well. Met a lot of great people here this week. Obviously, we're all from out of town, really. You know, Everett, you know, is still an Ontario guy, but we're not Hamilton people. And I'm from Winnipeg. Dan's from Calgary, and you know, to come in here this weekend and meet a lot of great people. It's been an awesome experience, and it's kind of unfortunate we're into the last game, but we've been treated to such an awesome weekend of volleyball.
Absolutely, and what a match here to kind of pin it off. It's just a cherry on top.
Yeah, this is the sprinkles, the cherry, the whipped cream topping, the chocolate, the caramel.
All of it.
Yeah, not peanuts, though. Dan's allergic.
Oh,
so, no,
Dan.
Keep those off, yeah.
Don't ruin the party.
No, you can have your sundae beside me. Don't worry.
Okay.
I'm not one of those ones.
Yeah, okay, yeah. Fair enough.
Yeah, he's not hypersensitive. And no shellfish either. No shellfish.
Oh, hey, man, I'm with you on that one.
Okay, so, guys, we're not going to Red Lobster after the game?
Nope, sorry about that.
Okay, all right. 16-13, Schreimer serve all the outside to McCarthy. Roll shot over. Schreimer keeps it alive. Kozlowski. High ball way outside to Slater, and the defense of McMaster, not quite sure if they thought he was really going to swing on that one there, but we saw the block peel off. Elliott was the only one up, and McCarthy was caught deep. Kind of an awkward set, awkward play there for McMaster defense to handle.
Great vision by Slater, though. The tendency would be to swing away on that ball, but he sees that up the target. Thank you very much. I'm just going to place that there.
Schreimer's serve goes long. Good lead there by Ungieski.
You know, we've seen a lot of the Spartan serves go way out of the back and leaving no doubt for McMaster. That one was much closer.
And now serving with a 17-14 lead is Stephen Marr, one of the top young prospects in our entire country. And that one finds the end line between Kozlowski and Shearhorn. And looks like Coach Josephson is saying, hey, that's been two. We missed two from this guy. This guy's got us twice, he says.
We're seeing the Trinity Western faithful not too happy with that call, and the Mac fans behind them just casually telling them to sit down.
Slater puts that ball in play. Coker back to McCarthy. McCarthy up the top of the block. Kept alive there by the Spartans. Schreimer outside to Plotkus, and Plotkus dug out there by Ungieski. Coker diving set out to the outside, and then Coppers misses the block and hits it long, but great diving effort there. Just gonna bumps it up in the air from Coker.
A real relaxed play too. A lot of setters would panic in that play. He just got his footing, took off 2 feet, and used both arms to put the ball up. A lot of guys go with one hand trying to get it real quick instead of taking the time to take it low.
Now Slater on the line. The Spartans trail by three. Jungjewski with the pass. Go pipe to Marr. Kozlowski with the dig. Schreimer quickly outside to Shearhorn. Kozlowski with the save. Betcher looks to just be up there for the block. Now we're going to have another pipe from Marr. Slater with the dig. Schreimer up high to Betcher in the middle. That ball's just too low. Underset there to Aaron Betcher.
Yeah, Schreimer unable to get his feet to the net there. He's kind of just trying to save that ball, and unfortunately doesn't have the hands to get it high enough for Betcher, who's, we've talked about aboard, is a high flyer, and we've seen he's swinging right at his face level there.
Now it is Elliott who will serve. 19-15 McMaster. Blocked this with the pass. Schreimer off the net, goes to Shearhorn. Coppers keeps it alive. Coker all the way back to McCarthy, and McCarthy's blocked there by Blake Shearhorn. And after that great start to the set by McCarthy, the Trinity Western block now is starting to key him up a little bit better.
You know, they're starting to key on him. They're aware of his presence on the net. Danny Demianenko hasn't been set in a while. They're not respecting him that much in the middle, especially in transition. So, you know, the key right now is on McCarthy.
We'll see what the center Coker does on this play here, as Betcher's serve always gives them trouble. And again, another ace for Betcher. He comes at it very high, and it's very flat. It's really difficult for these McMaster passers here to handle.
Shearhorn and Betcher very similar in their serving style. Well, it looks like the referee Taras is asking for just a few more wipes. Nice little time out here for McMaster as they wipe the floor.
Yeah, you got to take what you can get, right? Shout out to all the school students who've been here, you know, volunteering with the floor sweeping and floor cleaning. As that serve goes long, good lead there from Jungjewski. Doing the three ball system as well.
Yeah, members of the Smash Volleyball Club from here in Hamilton.
Yeah, they follow 204 on Instagram, so I'll give them a shout out. And a substitution checking in here for McMaster. We haven't seen this really too much this weekend, as Connor Santoni will check in for the Marauders. He will go back and serve.
Yeah, we've seen McCarthy put that ball along a few times, and Connor Santoni, younger brother to those who remember Tyler Santoni, was a fixture in the middle for the Marauders for a number of years, and after that played on the national team for a slight period of time.
Tough float serve, but they're able to find Gusev in the middle, and that gets by the libero, Jungjewski. And we'll see McCarthy check right back in at 2018.
And I was just going to say, you know, how much longer do we go before Trinity Western has to involve their middles? That's now only the sixth kill out of the middle position for Trinity Western, whereas McMaster's up to having 12 kills from their middles.
Great point, Dan. Similar to what we saw last night as well. Very reliant on Slater and Shearhorn are these Spartans. And that ball from Copper finds the line, but when you have players like Slater and Shearhorn, you can't fault them for giving them a heavy workload. They're able to handle it and are being very successful with it.
Absolutely. I think the talent of the Spartans lies down in the pins, not down the middle. You know, Goosen is kind of an awkward middle. He runs that slide, doesn't really run anything down the middle.
Pass from Antoniak off the net. Schreimer all the way back to Shearhorn. That's a great shot. Just really right over top of the block.
Yeah, that's, I mean, both Coker and Demianenko put up a pretty solid block, but Shearhorn, he's reaching way above 12 there.
Yeah, and that's his 12th kill of the match, and 24 between him and Slater. You talk about the outside efficiency. The only one, Plotkus, has only had one attempt and only one error in his attempt, so that's the one out of the three where you might want a little bit more involvement if you're not going to use your middles as much. But, hey, it worked for Trinity Western yesterday against Alberta, and maybe it's going to work today. You just rely a lot more on Shearhorn and Slater.
We have a timeout from Coach Josephson. 22-19, McMaster leads. Looking like they will, a couple points away at least from trying to take a 2-set-to-1 lead in this match, but I think we are a long, long way from over here, fellas.
No, absolutely. No matter what happens here in this third set, you know that Trinity Western's going to come back swinging, and McMaster's going to want to try to close it out here and get that chance to get, you know, get it over. You don't want to, if you're McMaster, you don't want this to go to a fifth, right? It's been a long tournament. Last night was a pretty late start, and you want to get this over as soon as possible.
Yeah, I'd agree with that, and I think whoever wins this set probably doesn't want any part of a fifth.
No, absolutely,
you know,
not.
If Trinity Western comes back, I think your worst nightmare, if you're up 2-1 in this match, would be to send it to a race to 15 for the home team. And if Mac wins this set here, you know, you don't want to give Trinity Western any life. They've already won a tough fifth set yesterday. You mentioned McMaster, they've only lost one set this whole tournament, and that was just the previous set to Trinity Western here. Demianko, big serve, taken there by Antoniuk. Houston keeps it alive, free ball coming now for the Marauders. Coker outside to Marr, and Marr, a good job there by Goosen to put that ball back to the master side. Marr's going to swing again and goes down the line and just misses it.
Yeah, poor set transition there by Coker. It was low, it was off the net, and Marr tries to do the best with it and put it in a deep corner, just out.
22-20 as Goosen goes back to serve. Betcher checks back into the front row. 2-point advantage for the Marauders in this third set. Marr, quick pass to Coker. They go back to him on the left. Great strap there from Goosen. Let's see if they can chase it down. Good effort there from Schreimer and Shearhorn. Luckily, your buddy Brad there.
Yeah.
He's okay.
He gives a thumbs up and everything's good.
He goes double check. Brad.
Brad, you good? He says that was fun.
The Silver Fox. 23-20 McMaster. That serve goes long. And, you know, we've seen that type of effort now from multiple players this weekend. And really, I mean, ultimately, this is what you work for all year. If you got to go flying into the stands or flying into the scorekeeper's table, that's what it's all about.
I mean, turn on Instagram or Facebook any morning, and what are the clips that are being shared from the weekend before, the matches before? It's the guys careening into the stands and into the signs. So, you know, maybe the hopes of Instagram glory there.
We see a nice block there from the Spartans, and it's now just a one-point game, 23-22, and Coach Preston will call his second and final timeout.
And I'd just like to comment just on that last block and blocking in general. I think since the first set, we've actually only had, I'm adding it up right now,
yep.
So 11 minus 6 would be 5 blocks. So now in sets 2 and 3, we've only had 5 blocks. And, you know, people might say, wow, it's not a blocking game then. You know, the blocks, there's not a lot of blocks, so the blockers aren't doing their jobs. But realistically, when you look at a match like this, the block has been doing their job. Then these are two great big blocking teams. The block's job is to get deflections that turn into offense. The block's job is to control the ball back to the defense. The block's job is to take up space and make sure that the offense doesn't have a lot of court to hit at. We haven't seen a lot of court to hit at. We've seen a lot of good deflections transitioning for offense. So the blockers on both teams doing their jobs. It's just like we've mentioned, the great attackers find a way to not get stuff blocked.
Yeah, we're just looking at two great offensive teams and attackers who can really excel at going around and finding those teams. So it's definitely not a testament to the lack of blocking from the teams and just the high level of offense that we're seeing today.
Back from the timeout, Schreimer serve taken by Young Jaski. Coker back to Marr, and Marr, soft block. Coker's there for the cover. They're going to call Marr on a center line violation. Not very happy with himself. We're going to see a substitution checking in here. It'll be Andrew Richards for Coppers. And it's 23 all.
Andrew Richards just brings a different energy to the floor. Obviously, his ball control is a huge asset. His ability on defense, he can swing away, but he just comes in, whereas Coppers a little even-keeled. Andrew Richards comes in with a lot of intensity.
Schreimer serve taken there by Richards. Coker all the outside to McCarthy. McCarthy soft block. Richards with the cover. They go middle to Elliott, and Elliott off the block touch. That's the correct call. Every linesman saw it. And now we have set point opportunity. We're going to see Coppers check back in for Richards. Great job there by Richards. A solid pass, two covers on the attack. Keeps the play alive. And now we'll see if Coppers can get in to get a big block to finish this set. It'll be Stephen Marr on the service line here for the Marauders. Set point opportunity, 24-23, but he nails it into the net. Now he never had a chance.
No, absolutely not. Maybe just a little distracted back there, maybe just a little worked up, but not the serve we're used to seeing from Marr.
No, it's he just unleashed on that one there, and it never got higher than the bottom of the net. Slater serve, taken there by Marr. Coker goes back to McCarthy. McCarthy, big time stuff block. Aaron Betcher puts down the hammer. Oh, that went down hard.
And that's a few times now we've seen McCarthy shut down in the set.
So now if you're Coker, you know, who do you go back to here? 25-24, set point opportunity for the Spartans. Slater serve, taken by Young Jeski, pass off the net. Coker to Copper, sets off the net. Dig up there by Slater. Schreimer goes all the outside. 1-on-1 to Shearhorn. A great dig. Ball coming here, free ball. Is it going to be in? Kozlowski takes it. Schreimer outside to Shearhorn again. And another soft block. Betcher there with the pass. Schreimer outside to Shearhorn. Shearhorn with the roll shot. And it finds the floor. And the Spartans come all the way back to take the third set, 26-24. And now are one set away from the national championship.
And great discipline attacking by Blake Shearhorn. High hands, extend the rally. Maybe one of the greatest decisions of the set was Kozlowski to take that ball when it was probably going out of bounds. It might have been out of bounds by a foot or two, but he was confident enough to take it and confident enough in his offense that he wanted to be the team to win the set. Right? He didn't want McMaster to lose that set. Taking that ball shows that he wanted control of the win.
Yeah, and two nights in a row now, we see Trinity Western kind of come back through the back door and steal a 2-1 lead.
Guys, we're going to have an opportunity here to check out some highlights from the third set, and what a set it was. It really felt like McMaster was in control the whole time, and Trinity Western battles all the way back and takes it, and now we're only one set away, and you know the dynamic of this match has really changed here with Trinity Western up 2-1. You see Shearhorn, again, just so effective with those off-speed shots. You can throw in the tip, throw in the roll. That ball was very close, as we see on the replay there. They thought it was out. It was very, very close. And guys, while these highlights are rolling, just want to give a big shout out to all of our production crew. Man, that guy's done a couple bicep curls in his day. As you see all the cameramen here, great job, guys. And also to our guys in the booth, our technical producer, Austin Chafe, our director, Jordan Caprice, and our producer, Cameron McKay. Great job to everybody we've dealt with this weekend. It's been a real pleasure getting to know everybody here, and it's just been an awesome, awesome experience. And obviously, thanks, guys. Just you know, from us, it's been a lot of fun working. Everett, Dan, lots of good times here working on the announce. But we're not done yet. That's the thing. Don't turn it off yet. We got a long way to go.
I'm gonna go on a limb and say we're gonna see a fifth set here. Much like last night, I think McMaster's gonna come back and take this set, but. You know, who's to see? So far, we've been in for a treat. It's been a great match so far, and I hope the fans at home are loving it as well.
Yeah, I think everybody is getting treated to just fantastic volleyball. And, you know, obviously, if you're a Mac fan or you're a Trinity Western fan, you have a lot riding on this match. But if you're just tuning in because you love volleyball, I don't know if you could ask really too much more.
Now, question for you guys. You guys have done this a few times. This is my first men's national championship, but as you've done this over the past few years, have you seen the difference? Have you seen, like, the skill increase in Canadian volleyball? Or, you know, how does it lay out over the years?
You know, that's a really good question. I think the game's a lot more physical than maybe when Dan and I were coaching at U of M together. We're seeing a little bit more size. But, I mean, you know, in terms of great players and really good teams, you know, you could probably debate that forever as to who those teams are. I think one thing is obviously, I mean, we're seeing more teams from the OUA and qualifying for some spots, so the dynamic of the Nationals has changed a little bit. You know, when I was there, we'd see kind of Dalhousie was usually a fixture, a couple teams, Montreal and Laval were usually always kind of there. So it's changed a little bit that way. I think it was great volleyball back then, it's great volleyball now. It's just maybe a little bit more physical, I would say.
Yeah, and with that physicality, I've recognized the difference in the forcing of the middle, especially using the middle as an overload for an offense rather than a spread. There's been a progression to using the middle to overload towards your pipe rather than to spread your outside hitters, using the middle coming in to overload to an outside rather than to go against the grain to the far set, right? So that's a big difference that I've seen in the game as it's progressed in recent years.
Yeah, I'd agree with that, Dan. As Coppers will put the first serve into play, taken there by Shearhorn. Kozlowski high ball, tips it over, taken there by McCarthy. Coker back to Demianenko, Kozlowski diving save. Schreimer, high ball, Kozlowski off the block, Maher diving save there, keeps it alive, finds Demianenko. But he can't get it past the block of Blake Shearhorn. First point of the fourth set goes to the Spartans.
Jared, interesting stats from the first three sets of volleyball. Shearhorn and Slater combining for 58 attempts already, whereas on the other court, Maher and McCarthy combining for 52 attempts. So very clear where those teams are going to be sending their offense throughout this match.
Coker to Maher, and the Trinity Western block continues to get some problems. And Demianenko goes up and swings. You know, the first two games of this tournament for McMaster, there wasn't a ton of resistance for Stephen Maher at the net. And as this match has gone on, you know, they're catching up to the speed, they're catching up to his shots, and he's going to have to probably try to change it up a little bit here in this fourth set if Mac wants to force a fifth. Demianenko, big serve there, and a joust between Schreimer and Elliott, but Schreimer's on the net. Serve point, McMaster, 2-1 now.
You might see Andrew Coker forcing Demyanenko a little bit more, much like Walsh and Arnett for Alberta. You know, they played club together, they played high school together. Now they're playing here at MAC. These guys go a long way back and they can find each other pretty much anywhere on the court.
Schreimer quickly to Slater, but a little bit, maybe too, not on the same page right. Maybe Slater was coming a little too fast and Schreimer missed him. Point for the Marauders.
That's two poor plays there by Schreimer as the last one into the net, and there a poor set there. Let's see how he bounces back with this next set.
3-1 Mac, Demyanenko serving, and that one goes into the net. Side out, Trinity Western. And it will be Goosen who will serve. Getting the signal from assistant coach Joel Jansen of where he wants that serve. He puts it right on the arms of Coppers. Jungjevski, high ball outside to Marr. And Marr looks for a touch, doesn't quite get it. Put a lot of pace on that one there, just missed the block.
Tend to agree with the no touch there.
So Goosen will serve again. Three all here in this fourth set. 2-1 Trinity Western leads. That one clips the tape. Good job from Coppers just to keep it alive. Marr goes cross court, Goosen with the dig. Schreimer on the run, goes out to Slater, and Slater cross court, gets Marr in the face.
Wow.
Great cross court shot there from Ryan Slater.
And you're wondering how that connection between Schreimer and Slater was going to be after that last one, but no problem there as he goes sharp cross. Wow, that's quite the skilled shot. And we mentioned it earlier about Slater's arm swing, how he sticks it. That's not a shot he could make a year ago.
No, definitely a much more well-rounded player now after that change as that tip from McCarthy goes into the net. 5-3 Trinity Western.
If anyone's not sure what Everett meant by that, it means that, you know, when a player has a drawback where they bring their elbow out around their side and bring their elbow to the side as they swing, they really can't hit direct shots along the net, cross-quarter line even. You know, and so he's really worked on getting that elbow closer to his body as he's coming back to swing and going through.
Marr high ball and powers it through the block and out, and I felt like that was a really big point there for McMaster. You know, it's still very early, but you don't want to let this get away from you here in this fourth set after a really an emotional third set loss there.
You're starting to see Marr get a little bit emotional, a little bit upset. Let's see if he can keep that in check and really stay even keel, because they're going to need him if they're going to come back here.
Block just pass off the net. They go quick outside to Slater again, and it catches Coker off guard. That's a real quick pace out there to Ryan Slater. Now it will be Schreimer serving. His serve is what really was the difference in that third set. He got them back into it late. They need to side out here right away on this serve. Jungjevski pass off the net. They go middle to Elliott, but Betcher and Plotkus are there to close the door. 7-4 now, Trinity.
Nothing working right now for McMaster. They're going to their different options, and everyone seems to be getting shut down.
I just sense a timeout coming here from Max soon if they can't get things going a little bit. Schreimer's jump float taken there by Coppers. Coker outside to McCarthy. And another block as Betcher is maybe starting to take this game over.
Yeah, and you're starting to see Stephen Marr get a little frustrated. He's like, give me the ball.
Right, and now as we have a timeout with Jared Totko being called by Dave Preston, yeah, we mentioned the blockers doing their job and the hitters just being one better than the blocker, hitting angles that the blocker couldn't block, hitting around, you know. And here now, at the end of the last set and now into this set, we've seen as many blocks from Trinity Western as we saw in the first 2.5 sets before that. And so it's a real change in terms of, number one, Trinity Western's doing a better job. As the match goes on, the block is always going to read the setter better, read the attacker better, right? Because they get those repeated reps and it's in their mind and they know what they're looking for now in the cues of the hitters. It's the hitter's job to maintain that discipline attacking, still finding high shots that are going to score. And I, you know, out of the timeout, I'm sure that that's what McMaster has to focus on doing, hitting shots that the block can't stop.
As we see Marr here on the court, he's going to want the ball. So if you're going to ask for it, you're going to want it. You got to make sure you come through for your team here and keep the support going. As the last thing you want to do now if you're McMaster at home is trying to let this one slip through as Coppers gets ace through the hands.
We've seen Coppers have service receive trouble after service receive trouble tonight. You wonder how short his lease is at this point. You got Andrew Richards into the game.
9-4 Trinity Western. McMaster needs a side out. Got to stop the bleeding here. Goffers with the pass, go back to Marr, and Marr blocked by Betcher. And right now, Aaron Betcher is the MVP of this set.
Absolutely, Aaron Betcher's showing up, he's shutting the door, and you know, a lot of frustration and negativity on the Marauders' side. Every play they make, every shot they make, they seem to be frustrated. At some point, they just gotta lighten up and enjoy playing the game.
And they needed that point badly. And, you know, the first two matches, you know, McMaster really having lots of fun, enjoying things, right? And lots of emotion, very positive, no negative at all. But it's easy to play like that when you're winning. And now is when they need that the most, as they're down in the hole here, 10-5, as Marr served. Taken there by Shearhorn. Schreimer, way off the net, goes back over to Slater there. And that's put over the net, Plotkus. Kept alive by Coker, bumps it outside by McCarthy. Coppers, and he's on the net. Yeah, saw that one from here. He came down on the attack on the net.
And as Everett mentioned, the frustration showing up now for McMaster as Marr not happy about that call. They've got to maintain their composure, right? They have the ability to come back in this set, but they'll only do it if they maintain their composure. Here we go, Slater back to serve.
Coker goes back row to Marr, and that ball's hit wide. And it just sort of seems like things are unraveling here a little bit for McMaster, and it really doesn't need to either. I mean, you knew this game was going to be hard. You mm-hmm. had to expect five sets to be down 2-1. You were still in the game. But now as you pile up the airs here at 12-5, it just gets more and more difficult. As Coker goes up to save that ball, goes to McCarthy, and again, the Trinity Western block. Not letting his McMaster attackers get anything through. What a great save there from Slater. Shearhorn, no block, rolls it over. Coker on the run, goes to middle to Elliott. And a great job there with a fifth-year middle, the captain of the team.
And maybe that's what they need, is that force to Elliott, the captain scoring that point to refocus them and give them the confidence moving forward. I think the block of Trinity Western got in their head a little bit, and now they just need to take that out of there and still hit disciplined shots.
Outside to Shearhorn, and that ball goes wide off the block. 13-6.
Great job for Shearhorn to go in there and just, you know, the block was there. He didn't have much real estate. Put it off the hands of McCarthy. Get the point. You don't need to be flashy. Take the Mac crowd out of it. Keep things simple. I mean, you've got a seven-point lead. Why not?
Jump flow here from Betcher. Not a great pass from Young Jayewski. Marr with bump set. Coffey's just going to put it over. Taken there by Plotkus. They go middle. A pipe, actually, to Slater. And, guys, McMaster needs help right now. You start to wonder the path Trinity Western has taken, you know, the role they've been on. I think they can taste it here at 14-6.
Yeah, right now we're seeing a much different Trinity Western than the past when they're winning, they're jumping, they're laughing, they're having a lot of fun, but right now they're focused and dialed in as misplay after misplay by the Marauders, and they're just throwing this one away.
Shearhorn left side, tips it over, Coker there, but it goes back to the Trinity Western side. Goosen could have hit it, but he just passes it up. They go to Plotkus, and Plotkus switched that ball into the net. But you can't wait any longer if you're Marauders. It's got to be now. McCarthy's got to do some damage on the service line.
Absolutely. Now, you McCarthy's here. You see Coppers. He's the next one to go back row. You're wondering if Andrew Richards has that paddle to come in for the Marauders.
McCarthy's serve. Great serve. Goes back to McMaster's side on the overpass. Coker goes pipe to Marr.
Wow.
That's the kind of play that'll get the crowd going. Great run there from Coker to Marr.
And earlier in the tournament, we talked about Marr and the energy that he can bring his team, but he needs to make big plays to have that big release of energy to motivate his team. That was a huge play.
Yeah, that was a player who's been frustrated the past few points, and he let it all go there.
McCarthy spin serve again, pass off the net. Kostoski goes way up high to Shearhorn. Shearhorn might have hit that ball on the other side of the net. It was so high. Schreimer read that dump very well, was there to take it. Kostoski, Shearhorn again. Tip. McCarthy's there to save it. We go to Coppers. Soft block back to the backside. Demianko, high ball to Coppers again. And that's dug up there by Kozlowski. Schreiner goes tight to Slater. McCarthy gets a piece. Coker keeps it alive. But Coppers can't put it over. And Coach Preston, you can see, not too pleased that that dig from Kozlowski didn't get called. It was a little bit ugly.
Yeah, that was some Pizza Hut deep dish right there. Chicago style even. That brings us back to the 80s on the beach from Kozlowski there. But, you know, the referees have put away their whistles on hand calls the entire time, and you know it takes a lot to get a call there.
15-8, we're 1 point away from the potential timeout. Carter Bergen has subbed in. Coppers with a pass to go middle to Demianko. Got a soft block. They go pipe to Mar, just tips it over. Bergen's going to step in and set to Shearhorn. That goes through the block. Jeske with the dig. Coker outside to Coppers. And a huge dig there from Slater. And Schreiber chases
alive.
It down. Kozlowski puts it over. Let's see if Mack can get a point here. Middle. And Demianko squeezes it through the block position. The Spartans thought they had the block on that one. It was close.
You know, Ben Josephson kind of does the shuck sign as he knows that every point McMaster gains here, every more bit the crowd gets into this game, is going to get tougher and tougher for these Spartans to close this game out.
Yeah, you got to basically outscore them 2-1 here down the stretch. If you're McMaster, just keep chipping away on your serve. Pipe to Slater, and that finds the sideline. 16-9, Trinity Western, and they are just 9 points away from their third national championship in 5 years.
Absolutely. Now, if you're Dave Preston, Dan, what do you say of this timeout? How do you get these guys to calm down and just focus on the game plan?
Well, I think you want to just approach it in terms of, you know, coming out. How are you going to arrange your block defense to stop? As you come back in volleyball, we know that you have to serve and hold, which means you have to serve, you have to defend. You're not going to do this just on offense. You can't side out to win this set. You've got to find a way to block and align your defense. And I think it's tough because Trinity Western hasn't used their middles a lot lately. They've done a good job going to the outside, but that's when they're going to catch you off guard. So you don't want to tell your middles just to go and release because they can catch you off guard. But you got to go with what statistically they've been doing, running the ball to Sherholm, running the ball to Slater. Focus on those two guys, right, and shut those two guys down. If you're going to get beat, you're going to get beat by some other option other than those two guys.
Absolutely. And if you're Trinity Western, you're just playing side-out volleyball at this point, you know. You've got a 7-point lead here. You're only 9 points away. So they just need to stay relaxed and understand that, you know, 1 point doesn't matter, but they got to bounce back right away.
Trinity Western has almost completely ignored the C-ball as well. So you got to, on offense, if you're McMaster, realize they haven't paid attention to McCarthy. Can you trust him to get you back, get you this set? They're not paying attention to him.
I mentioned before the timeout, Trinity Western won gold in 2011 and 2012. They were silver in 2010 and 2015. So a lot of success the last few years. They're looking for their fifth medal since 2010, which is very impressive, and their third gold. And if you're McMaster, you've had two recent bronze medals and a silver in that loss to Laval in 2013 in search of their first ever CIS gold medal in men's volleyball. So there's a lot of history on the line here, especially when you consider it's the 50th anniversary of this tournament. Mar, left side, off the block and into the crowd. And, you know, Matt's doing a good job siding out, but that's not the issue. The issue is scoring points on your serve when you're down by six.
Absolutely, and you're going to see the McMaster servers are hopefully going back and getting more and more aggressive. You know, if they put that ball in play, they've got to force some errors.
17-11 with Coker on the service line. Shearhorn out of the back row, off the block, and long. I don't know how you defend that shot.
You know, they did a good job. Mar identified it. He didn't stay inside because there wasn't a C ball.
Hey, and a call around. Back row attack on Shearhorn. Wow.
Yeah, I think referee Tarasuki was just waiting to see where he was lined up. And once he saw that he was in the back row, he gave the point to Mac. So that's a bit of a break. 17-12 is a lot better than 18-11, I'll guarantee you that. Now only a 5-point game. Let's see if Coker can get his team another point. Oh, he doesn't take advantage of it. Puts that serve into the net.
Missed serves by Mack are killing them here.
6-point advantage as Plock just checks back into the front row. Schreimer goes to the service line. Schreimer's jump float taken there by Coppers. Not a great pass. McCarthy's going to set it. Mar just puts the free ball over. Taken by Betcher. Schreimer outside cooking to Slater. And Slater right by Stephen Mar. 19-12, Trinity Western.
And Trinity Western just calm, cool. You know, they're just doing their job, and that's all they need to do. They started this set so well. Betcher's blocking really made a difference, and Trinity Western just had to stay the course. They've got a fourth national title.
That tip from Elliott doesn't get over the net. 4-hit violation. And now it's 20-12, and Coach Preston will call his second and final timeout. And this McMaster team is going to need a huge run to try to come back in this fourth and force a fifth set. They said, if you're Coach Ben Josephson, I think you can start to taste what you've tasted before, and that's very close to another CIS gold medal.
And you know what? This is the testament of how hard this Trinity Western team has worked. We said it, they kind of squeaked into the playoffs. We're down 1-0 in their first round series against Calgary, and then since that first loss in the first round series, they have been impeccable and haven't lost a match and have really truly been probably the best team in the country.
You know, and Everett, Dan and I were talking last night about how, and this really is, if Trinity Western can pull this off, an incredible story for their season. I mean, yes, they've had a lot of talent. Yes, people would expect them to be one of the best teams coming this season after last year's silver medal finish, but they were on the brink. You know, people were, you know, all I heard all year is, Trinity Western's not very good this year. I heard that multiple times from multiple people in different parts of the country. They went on a big run, got very hot at the right time, put it all together, and now they look amazing, and maybe that might be the nail in the coffin. Oh,
wow.
My. Ryan Slater absolutely slams Stephen Marr, and then just turns back to his team like he does it for his day job.
The 13th block for Trinity Western, only three blocks for McMaster tonight. That has been a major difference.
21-12, Trinity Western. Coker outside to McCarthy, and McCarthy dug up there by Shearhorn, way into the roof. Kozlowski, bump set to Slater. Slater with the roll shot. Coker comes all the way across. Great save. Kozlowski's going to step in here. Goes out to Ploctis, but Ploctis is blocked by McCarthy and Elliott. 21-13.
Yeah, whatever the McMaster Marauders need to get this team or this crowd back in it, you know, you could hear a pin drop after that block on Marr, and now he goes back there. We all know he has the ability to light the fire on the baseline, and if he can put a few aces here, you know, the Disney comeback might be available.
Well, Marr is probably their most dangerous server, but the tendency in this situation might be to try to get all eight back at once with one serve. Let's see what kind of serve Marr puts into play here. Very tough serve. McCarthy's going to go up and hit it, and he kind of misjudge, just tipped it back to the Trinity side. Slater, right side, and they're blocked there by Elliott and Coppers, bailing out Jason McCarthy. Still though, 7 points. I really like that serve there from Marr. He went after it, but he didn't try to, you know, go for the automatic ace. He's put good pace on it, set up his defense and his block, and that one there, a miss hit. And now, Spartans only 3 points away.
That is probably the second nail in the coffin there, as, you know, Elliott does have a good serve, and as does McCarthy, but their ability to put pressure on is definitely in doubt as Trinity Western's 3 points away.
Slater taken there by Young Jaski. And that swing from Coppers is long, 23-14. And you look at the Trinity Western bench, and these guys are ready to explode. They feel that this title is almost theirs. And what a roller coaster ride of emotions they have been on this season. And if they can finish this off here, it will put the final page in what's been an unbelievable story for this team. Missed serve there from Slater, though, 23-15. And you're McMaster, I mean, you're at home. Really, if you're Elliott here, I mean, you've got to be getting everything you've got to try to pull off the big comeback. Pass there from Ploctis, outside to Shearhorn, and Shearhorn dug up there by Elliott. Great job. Demianko sets outside to Coppers. Dug up there by Kozlowski. Schreimer quickly again to Shearhorn. Demianko got a piece. It goes back to the Trinity Western side. The ball's passed real tight. Great job from Schreimer to go up and get it. And then Slater comes out of the back row. And guys, I'm gonna make an early prediction. I think Ryan Slater's the MVP of this championship. And it's now just 1 point away as the very small, outnumbered cheering section from Trinity Western is up on their feet. 24-15. This is not what the Mac faithful hoped for, but Trinity Western doing their best to ruin the plans, and that ball goes long. So we're going to get another opportunity. It will be McCarthy who will serve with the championship on the line for the Spartans. 8 point advantage. It's going to require some big time defense and block here from the Marauders. McCarthy serve, taken there by Kozlowski. Schreimer outside to Shearhorn. Great dig, Young Jaski. Can McCarthy chase it down? It's going to be a free ball coming here for the Spartans. Kozlowski with the pass. Quickly outside to Shearhorn, off the top of the block. And Coker, great job not to fall down there on their side. Play continues. What a scramble play here. Shearhorn one more time. Demianko gets a piece, but not enough. And with that, your 2016 CIS National Champions and the 50th anniversary of the tournament are the Trinity Western University Spartans. And what a season! Trinity golden again in Hamilton.
Wow, as you see the jubilant hug from the Spartans and their coaching staff. We talked about it again. They weren't necessarily expected to be here, even heading into the playoffs, and really a Cinderella run from this Trinity Western Spartan team. They come into this McMaster Gymnasium, into the Burridge, and get the job done and get that big 3-1 win. You know, they weathered that first set storm and came back to some solid volleyball, which is exactly what we expected from the Spartans.
You know, it's interesting talking to Coach Josephson yesterday before the match against Alberta, you know, talking about how he prepared his team for that match, and he wanted to stress to his team that it was no mistake that they beat Alberta in the Canada West semifinals, and of course he wanted to stress to his team that it wouldn't be a mistake if they beat them again yesterday, and they brought that energy in today. They learned from this season, and even though they were down and out in that first set, they kept their poise, showed their resilience, adapting. Their block just got better and better throughout the match. Their offense got better and better, and they finished this match on top in the CIS.
Absolutely, and you have to wonder, you know, we've talked about it, the strength of the Canada West Conference and how these guys have to battle night in, night out in every single one of their matches. We saw their ability to come back from the deficit last night against Alberta, who, you know, many consider the best team in the league. And, you know, McMaster just not used to this kind of pressure all throughout the season. No matter where you go, you know, if you play in Poland or if you play Ohio State down in the States, those are exhibition matches and there's nothing on the line. And, you know, especially the second or third and fourth set when things were on the line, we saw a little bit of hesitation from the Riders. We saw some pitfalls, tip balls. We saw some troubles on serve receive. And realistically, they just didn't get the job done when they needed to.
You see the player of the game here for McMaster in his fifth and final season, his last game ever as a Marauder, Alex Elliott, a fitting send-off. And so guys, just the one point I want to make is that the top two teams all year long, in everybody's opinion, were McMaster and Alberta. And Trinity Western beat those two teams to win this title. And that's something that's incredibly impressive, and I think I couldn't agree more with this player of the game from Trinity Western, Aaron Betcher, was phenomenal. And you know, I think when you can look back and say, man, we beat the two best teams. And I bet if you ask Coach Ben Josephson, you know, they might say that they still think those two teams are better than Trinity Western, right? They might think that, you know, if you play these games 10 times, Alberta and Mac might beat them more often. But that's not what this tournament is all about. This tournament is about being your best for three games and being better than you for one weekend and preparing for that. And it's unbelievable job by Trinity Western.
I believe it was back in 2007 when the Winnipeg Westmen won their last national championship in this very gym. They beat Alberta. And, you know, afterwards, Larry McKay was asked about the win. He goes, you know what? The thing about the CIS national championship is that you don't have to be the best team in the country. You just have to be the best team in the country on that weekend. And whether or not you think the Spartans were the best team in the country over the entirety of the season, they were the best team in the country over the past two weekends.
Yeah, and it's not about who is the best all year, right? And that's what makes it. We want to find out who the best team was on this weekend. And as we see some all-star selections here for the tournament, Jordan Nowakowski, very deserving. It was just unbelievable on that Thursday match. Mm-hmm. And still very solid on Friday and Saturday as the Huskies finished in fourth place this weekend. From Trinity Western, Ryan Slater.
And Slater really turned it on for this match. 19 points. Led the team, and after Shearhorn's performance yesterday to get him here, you know, Shearhorn still had 18 points, definitely no slouch, but Slater really turned it on for the Spartans, and that was the difference after the first set.
From McMaster, Danny Demianko. You know, guys, my question to you is, you know, where do you go now? Where do you go from here if you're McMaster, right? You know, how much harder do you have to train? How, you know, what do you do differently in your season knowing that, you know, you return your entire roster, every starter except for Alex Elliott. You know, it's a hard situation to be in if you're not to come back to do it one more time next year.
Yeah, but, I mean, ultimately, you can't win a CIS championship every year, right? They've been here, and they've been here repeatedly. It shows a lot about their program. Next year, as mentioned, they return everyone except Alex Elliott. You know, in terms of their mentality moving forward, they're in a good situation. These guys have a chance to win a CIS national championship again.
right? And they were here. There's nothing should be taken away from this team for what they've done over the last few years, being in the CIS championships and getting to the medal matches again and again and again.
You know, and I think one thing that's really important for everybody who's out there who's watching, and I think, you know, there's sort of that, they want it, the tendency, you know, Mac, you know, they really let themselves down, you know, they could have done better. You know, I think they played really well this whole season and this whole weekend, and you look at the last couple of years, they've got up against really great teams, right? And at this time of the year, that's what it's all about. I mean, they came out here and competed, and if they win that third set, I mean, you could almost feel it, right? As coaches, as fans of the game when you play, you could just sort of feel that third set. Whoever won it was probably going to take the match, and I think it would have been really difficult for Trinity Western to win this match if McMaster won the third.
As the tournament MVP gets announced here, and who else? The Golden Boy, Blake Shearhorn, getting it done in his home province. He's never played in Ontario before as a member of the Trinity Western Spartans. He's from down the road in Cobourg, same town as Alex Elliott on the other side of the net. And you know this means so much more to him, possibly just because he was able to get it done in front of his family and friends.
Yeah, and this doesn't, you know, it doesn't feel good right now if you're McMaster, right? And, you know, obviously, as competitors, it won't. But they've had an unbelievable season. They've had an unbelievable run with this group. And the lucky thing about it, like we say, Dan, is it's not over yet, right? It's not over yet for this group. Yes, Alex Elliott is done, but they have one more chance at it. And this group, each season, they continue to get more and more battle-tested. And they're going to be a very, very tough team to knock off next season. As will Trinity Western, as they only lose one player as well as Kozlowski. We look at Alberta, right? They lose Barnes and they lose Lawrence, and you know they'll be there. And there's lots of other teams around the country too that'll be nipping at all these teams, and it just sets up for another unbelievable tournament next season in Alberta.
Yeah, next season, the championship in Alberta. The Golden Bears are going to look to get back at the top of their game. And you know, but if you're the McMaster Marauders, you're kind of thinking, like, what do we have to do? When is this going to be our turn? When are we going to get the job done? This is four straight medals for the Marauders, not of that gold color. You know, sure, their last final wasn't back until 2013, so a lot of these guys have, you know, haven't really been there before, but at the end of the day, you're going to wonder, you're at home, you have the team that you do, maybe this was your shot.
Yeah, maybe, right? You know, definitely, you would think at home, right, would have been your best situation, but this game, I think the fourth set, 125-16, it kind of leaves a bit of a bad taste in your mouth, right, which kind of is unfortunate, but really, they win that third set, and I'm thinking they were going to win this match, and that was kind of the deciding set to me, and especially the way when they were up, and it was very close, but Trinity Western, I mean, this is a team that everybody was counting out, had to go on the road in the first round, had to beat Alberta to make nationals on that first night, they did that. Had to beat a very tough Saskatchewan team to win the Canada West Conference, right? If they don't win that match, they're coming here as the 5 seed, and they're playing Mac in the semis. Who knows what happens in that match, right? I think Trinity's keep getting better each time they played. Then they come here, and Ryerson gave Trinity a good run on that first day. They made Trinity work for that match. And then, of course, the absolute classic we saw last night against Alberta. Everybody won in that one. Anybody who was watching came away thinking, you know, how great of a match that was. And then tonight, I think we got treated to three amazing sets of volleyball. Fourth set, you know, got away from the McMaster a little bit. We didn't quite have that same compete level in the first three, the same intensity, because the score got away a little bit. But Mac fought to the end. They didn't roll over, and they made Trinity Western earn every single point. And both these teams are very deserving to be in this situation.
Yeah, absolutely. And Trinity Western, it has to really be a testament to Ben Josephson and his coaching staff. They were prepared for this match. And like you said, in that first set, they're getting slaughtered. And what's Ben Josephson doing? He's sitting there and he's taking notes, right? After that set, you know, they gained a little bit of momentum. We thought that was going to make a difference. And at the end of the day, it did. You mentioned that you're not sure if Trinity Western's here last night. If not for the win over Alberta last night, I think that's true. You know, it's just part of that story. They had to overcome that Alberta team the second time. You've seen it so many times. It's really hard to beat a team twice in a row. And having beat them last weekend in the Canada West playoffs and going down, I remember Joel Jansen telling us before the game yesterday, he goes, you know what? I wouldn't be surprised if they kicked the crap out of us 3-0, because that's the way Alberta looked when they were coming in. They were men possessed, and we saw that in the first set. Trinity Western weathered the storm, and then they got it done in the fifth. Tonight, they weathered the storm of the first set. They took the crowd out of it. And after that set, you know, they kind of snuck in that third set where McMaster had the lead the entire time. Now, as Dave Preston gets his medal, you know, four straight CIS medals for his team. And you can tell it's not the color he wanted.
And here's the point, guys. They're the only program in the country who's done that in the last 4 years. Right? They're the only team who's medaled four straight national championships now. That's something that's pretty impressive.
Absolutely.
Right? And when you look big picture, right, and you talk about, you know, everything that means, not just this one game, right, you look at our country, the kids who are watching this game today, right, the motivation, the inspiration they take from this game. You look at the players who are playing this tournament, not just in this match, but as a whole, them moving on to our national team program, right, and then you get the excitement of knowing how many returning players are in this tournament to come back next year. I think we're in good shape. I think CS Volleyball is going in the right direction. And this was just an awesome weekend to be a part of. That's the only thing I can say about it. It was just a great time to be here. And we really were treated to spectacular volleyball all weekend long.
You know, this is a third and fourth player heavy tournament. We've talked about it before. Only one or two graduating guys on the Spartans. Only one guy on McMaster. Only two guys on Alberta. We're going to see a lot of these players again. And just like you said, you know, if you're Vincent Pichette, who's up there, who's taking stats, who's watching this, you're kind of licking your lips knowing who's leaving the Canadian national team program and seeing these kids come up. You know, you're already aware of them. A lot of these guys running the floor have already won the Maple Leaf before. They've already competed for Canada. But as you see the progression here and the type of matches that are going on, you know, volleyball in Canada is definitely in a good place.
Yeah, as we see, still a couple medals being handed out here as Aaron Betcher grabs his gold medal. He really was great tonight, second year middle.
You know, he's someone that I'd love to see play for Team Canada somewhere down the road. Athletic, level-headed, he made a huge difference tonight.
Yeah, this is, we see one of the injured players here, Braden Heppel, sorry. He got injured at practice this week. He was healthy to start the week. It's very unfortunate at the end of the year to suffer an injury, but I believe Pearson Ashenko also injured. And then kind of cool seeing Devin Plett. And Plett went to Trinity Western, was off for a couple years, had some injuries to get through, and now back in it. And you know, great guy, Devin Plett, really nice guy. For Hayashi, lost that club national final last year with the Nukes, right? And now him and Jacob Kern both here get a gold medal in their first season. As you see the coaches, Ben Ball, he's pretty familiar with this stage now, both as a player and as a coach. Joel Jansen, always got the flowing blonde locks there on the sideline for the Spartans. And then Ben Josephson. He's been on quite the run here, guys, with Trinity Western. And, you know, they were already, but this win just firmly entrenches them into one of the best runs a program has ever probably been on in CIS history. Set three golds in 5 years now, and if it wasn't for those 2 years against Western, they're kryptonite. I mean, that's Ben Josephson. Every time he sees the draw and sees that they're not in it, he's probably pretty happy as they defeated them 2 years in a row. And now we're going to see the captains of the Spartans come forward. Slater, Kozlowski, and Ploctis to accept the trophy and the banner. That's a great sight if you are a Trinity Western University Spartans fan. I think they're ready to flood the court here. That'd be a great feeling, no doubt about it. You know, and if you're McMaster, that's the last thing you envision is somebody else on your court doing that to you. But unfortunately, you know, storybook endings are for stories and movies pretty much a lot of the time, right? And this is real life. You got a lot of dynamics to consider here. And Mac was very, very close to doing this, doing this on their own court. And it would have been quite the story if it happened. But a fantastic weekend nonetheless. And I think we're going to have a chance here. Amanda's going to try to grab a couple of the Spartans players. So if you are out there watching, make sure to stay tuned as Amanda's been doing a great job all weekend long. Doesn't want to crash the celebration here, obviously, though.
We got a first-hand view of this Spartan celebration
right in front of us here at the announcer's table. So unfortunately for all the McMaster fans, they go home disappointed. I think the roof would have literally blown off this base if Matt could have pulled it out. I think the post-game celebration in town would have been pretty wild as well. But
one thing to consider as well is that the female Spartans are playing in the semifinals of their CIS championship tonight against UBC, and we could very well have a Spartan sweep here in CIS volleyball.
See, Amanda's down there on courtside. She's working, doing her best to try to get us an interview with one of the guys who is going to take their team photo, as is customary tradition here, right? Championship photo with the banner and the trophy and the gold medals. All the coaches and the staff and the players. Once again, though, guys, I think it's just really, I want to make mention of all the great people we've met this weekend, and it's McMaster first class host. I know it's always hard when you know, you put so much energy into running the event, and sometimes you don't get to really enjoy the event, right, with your own team playing in it. I think there was a really good mix and blend of that. I think the staff here, everybody really helped out, and you can take a look around. I mean, this affects more than just the team. I mean, the people, all the staff, the university, everyone's been helping out this weekend. They were all in this together, and it really is, you know, it's hard for all of them to handle. But this is a first-class university, first-class program. And it's four straight years the national medal. Mm-hmm. And that's something that's incredibly impressive, a model of consistency. And you hope for them next year in Alberta that, you know, for that core, they can take that last big step. There's going to be a lot of programs who are, you know, there's 50-year guys going to be all across the country. They're all going to want to do the same thing.
You know, but, if you're – sorry, continue.
I was going to say, just that we see all the referees embracing. I mean, this is a big event for everybody involved, right? I mean, referees, all the staff, the volunteers, everybody here, they all come. It's all a CIS national championship for everybody involved. As you see Trinity Western really celebrating now. We see a couple of McMaster players sharing an embrace, and it's going to be a tough next few months for the McMaster Marauders.
And you know, if you're the Trinity Western Spartans, if not only these guys, but the entire team, the organization, every time there's a national championship in McMaster, you're going to circle that on your calendar, because that's another one they've kind of stole. You look back to a few years ago, you've referenced it before, they kind of came in and stole away. Josh Howitson went nuts on the service line that year, and once again here, they kind of stole the show from what was supposed to be the McMaster Alberta show.
All right, everybody, we do have now Amanda Dunwell on the court side with Ryan Slater.
How are you feeling right now?
Pretty great. Just been such an amazing season. To see how far we've come to make it to this point is just amazing. And I'm so happy to be a part of this team, just to get to play every day with these guys. And yeah, it's been so good.
You know, third set, you guys were a little down. That was a big turnaround. That was a big turning point.
Yeah.
What was the leading factor in that third set?
I think that we've gained a lot of confidence over the last few weeks in just how to play resilient. That's something that's taken us a whole season to learn, but we've been just pushing away, and I think that we've really become a resilient team and a tough team, and I think that showed where, you know, we lost the first set, but we were able to come back through the whole match. So yeah, I'm really proud of our team being able to do that.
So you were up against a pretty big matchup. We were looking up against you and Stephen Marr, you on the outsides. You know, how do you go up against people like that? And I mean, you yourself are a force to be reckoned with, but when you're going up against those other sides, you don't see them a lot. What is the strategy?
Yeah, there's not a lot of guys out there who can hit the ball like Stephen Marr. So, we knew that we'd have to key on him and Demi and Echo as well. We tried to make sure that we could just pull them off the net so they couldn't run as much middle, and then we'd be able to just focus more on Marr. And it took us a while because he was really getting momentum in the beginning of the match, but we started to figure it out a little bit, got our hands a bit lower, a bit tighter, and it just comes from trusting our block and trusting our system that we're going to start to get those good touches, and eventually we did, and eventually we got the stops that we needed down the stretch.
You know, I don't want to let you miss a photo op, so we are going to let you go back and celebrate with your team. Thank you so much, Ryan, and congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Thanks. Back to you guys.
Thank you to Amanda Weldon. Amanda did a great job all weekend long. And guys, that's going to pretty much wrap everything up here for us. And Everett, Dan, it's been a lot of fun. I think everybody involved, all the guys in the truck, everybody from Mohawk College as well, did a great job. And this was really a first-class event, first-class volleyball all around.
Yeah, big thanks to McMaster for having us out here and putting us on the mic. It was lots of fun doing with you guys. I think we've set a standard, guys, for volleyball broadcast. It needs to be a three-man show.
I think this is a new experiment. Dan, it's great to be back in the booth with you. Any final thoughts before we wrap?
This was outstanding. And again, thank you to McMaster for allowing us to be here and for taking us in and trusting us with the broadcast. for any young volleyballers out there, what a true lesson here from Trinity Western. And we heard Slater talk about it, resilience and trust in your process and trust in your systems. But, you know, if you would have looked at Trinity Western just a couple weeks ago, they thought they were down and out. They might not even make playoffs, mm-hmm. right, in the Canada West. And now look at them. Here they are, CIS National Championships, resilience and trust.
Great point, Dan. So Trinity Western comes to Hamilton, and they spoil the hometown party. But a great weekend all around. Thanks to everybody who watched. Thanks again to Mohawk College and everybody at McMaster. It's been fun. We'll hopefully see you next year in Edmonton. Take care.